Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining me for this live session where we will consider the likely prospect for Bitcoin for the 2015 and beyond. We have a short agenda. Let me share the screen first of all so you're able to see. And whilst we are sorting that out, could someone indicate to me that the sound is good? You can interact with me by using the chat on the TV, Trading View, under name Dan V.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining me for this live session where we will consider the likely prospect for Bitcoin for the 2015.
Okay, so you can participate by using this chat room here. Dan V charting the waves. You can post your questions there, but I would appreciate if somebody can just confirm for me that the sound is good. Okay, that's great. So we will commence, and let me just outline to you what we will be covering today. So in sort of a brief, we'll go over very, very briefly how I approach technical analysis and why sometimes there might appear to be discrepancy between what I might say and what others are anticipating. So I will briefly go over that and how I apply it. Likewise, I will clarify what I intend to accomplish by sharing my analysis, by publishing my analysis. Sometimes there are misconceptions about exactly what I'm saying. So some individuals have come back to me and either have questioned what I said and saying that this doesn't hold, or are in some way wondering the reasoning behind why I publish a particular move or price action in the days to come. So once I've clarified that, then we will go into a point where the differentiation between analysis and trading. Some will, for example, come back and say once the chart is posted, they will assume that I will then follow that chart to the letter without any adjustment, without any review, and of course that won't work. Trading is not the same as technical analysis, because within the technical analysis you anticipate a particular move, then the trade has to be planned to both including entry, exit, money management, all that. So there is a difference between trading analysis and trading. So once you finish with that, then we'll go into the real subject which we are looking at in the Bitcoin as it is related to USD, because most of us are following Bitcoin USD pair or currency. Some of you are following one with a Chinese yuan, but nevertheless, same concept will apply. We'll look at its relationship with S&P 500 to see whether it gives us any insight. We will also then go into reviewing our counts we have been following for some time and whether there is a reason to make any adjustment to that. And if so, what likelihood, what likely adjustment we need to consider or keep in our mind, so that when the price actions unfold, we are not completely caught off guard because we are only looking at one particular outcome. So we'll look at other factors in that. We will look at like a textbook schematic diagram of common corrections and see which one of these fit best for the price action that has been unfolding since November 2013. We will then go into look at if the recent low we had in January 2015 is indeed a significant low, or is that a low which is, just a part of this corrective cycle which will eventually be taken out again before the final low is formed. We will then look at what outcome we can anticipate. So that's the general agenda. But as always, these are my thoughts, and I am not encouraging or recommending in any way that any one of you trade based on what I see. So you will hopefully do your own analysis in order to meet your own particular requirement for your own trading style and your personality, and of course, your trading account size. So once that is away, let's get on with the look at briefly the technical analysis, how I apply it, and what I intend to accomplish by this. And the trading analysis is different from trading itself. So when we are looking at some of the charts that I've published, for example, this particular chart you'll see in some of my published chart, this one was one that I published. And when I did, I indicated that we were just coming off this low and we were looking for a leg up in a zigzag form back toward the upper end of this congestion. And in fact, we did have that. I was then expecting another leg down. So when on the chart, I posted these particular lines, which in fact I haven't changed since I published it. So you'll be able to cross-reference it. I haven't changed at all. But you know, if someone then say, well, you put a straight line here, and over here you put a zigzag. You know, it doesn't make sense. It looks different. Well, it does. But if you remember, this is a schematic diagram where I'm trying to explain that in this particular price section here, in this section, we're expecting every single leg to have three swings, a zigzag. In the Elliott wave, they will call that one like a 3-3-3-3-3, where every swing is a three swing or three minor swings within that, called WXY. So if I was to do all that on this chart will look so busy that the price itself will be clouded by the various marks that I will put on there. So I didn't do the three swings in there, but I'm just, you know, by this schematic diagram, expecting that one line to represent this zigzag up, and then likewise a line down to call zigzag down. So when I put a line up there, sometimes I will try and actually put out the full shape of a outline that I'm expecting. However, when I posted this one, you will go back and have a look. It's approximately, I think, August 2014 when I was expecting it, and I was expecting a potential low around this sort of time, around back end of December, early January. Well, we in fact had low a little bit later on, but the point I was making there is that this pattern is not going to be over before late December, early January. That's basically what I was trying to convey. So sometimes, you know, when I indicate this line, one mustn't assume that just because this line looks different from a schematic diagram, that is wrong. Second thing is I am expecting a certain price action which is outlined. Now, who is to know, for example, that they will both, this W, X, Y will be an equal length. So what I mean by that is, who is to know that we will have a W and then we'll get a retracement and then we'll have Y, and that this leg will be equal to that. There are common relationships. Sometimes this leg is indeed equal to this one. But there are other times when this leg might be shorter. It might be shorter like this. And this one might be like 161% or more of the length of the initial leg. And there are times when, for example, this leg will be longer and the second leg that follows will be shorter. And now nobody could know that. There is no system, there is no methodology. So when I'm putting these lines out, it's basically sketching out what I'm expecting to see. So it's just like, if you are asking somebody a direction to a place and they are giving you some landmarks, these landmarks will be like general pointers that you will look out for. They may not be in exactly the same place that you anticipate or you thought the one who is guiding you is indicating, but you will look out for those kind of things. So this is basically what I intend to do when I publish this chart. So when a lot of the charts are published, people say, oh, your line was pointing to 500 over here. But we know we never got to 500, we only got to 450. The intention of putting these lines is not to indicate an exact level, but there are times when we get a structure like this one that clearly the upper limit and the lower limit are relatively clearly marked out. So then one can be reasonably accurate. But when we don't have that, and I'm putting lines out, they're only generally indicating. So for example, if we look at this short-term time frame here, I could be wrong, but I'm expecting that we had this leg down, just like this diagram that I'm showing you here. We had this leg down, then we've got, I think, a correction. And that correction took place in A, B, and C zigzag. And you can see that this swing is relatively short compared with this one. But nevertheless, it's a zigzag retracement. So it has apparently retraced this leg up to here. Then we started a down cycle, I think. And I could be wrong, as I say, but I think we have started a down cycle. So we had the first leg down. Then we've got this A, B, and C, or a W, X, and Y, kind of a zigzag back to the upside to retracing this leg. So what now should follow, we should have a second part of that zigzag down. So we have this first leg down, retracement, we should have a second leg down. And both of these will be equal to or comprise of the same cycle as this leg here and that one there. So this was also some kind of a zigzag. We retraced back zigzag. We should also have a zigzag down to approximately that kind of level. So the very fact that I indicated here doesn't mean that I'm expecting price to be at 198. It could finish up there. It could, in fact, just come here and make a double bottom. Or, in fact, it could continue lower and maybe come down even further, like 180 somewhere. So when I'm indicating these lines, I try to give some indications of where I think it's going to go, but just because where I put a line here with a upswing coming up from there doesn't mean I'm expecting it to be exactly at 100 or 200 or 180. So it's a zone. Somewhere in that area, I'm expecting a low. Then I'm expecting another swing up, and that swing up will be similar to this leg. You see, that's why I anticipated it's going up there. And then, of course, we've got other things lining up where 300 to 320 looks reasonable. So that's the way I'm approaching. I can go in and put an exact level by means of using common Fibonacci relationship, like, for example, using this leg here, and say that we could be approximately 61.8% or 78% or 100 or 120 or 138. And you can see then lines get so busy that you won't really get an idea of where this thing is going to go. So that's basically what I'm trying to indicate. So whenever you look at my charts, what you should focus on is not exactly where these lines go or end, but rather the kind of general shape we are looking to see unfold. Okay. And that way you will avoid either being overly critical about where my line is expected to go, and where I thought was supposed to be going, or where you think I indicated it should go. And the fact that, you know, somebody might say, well, look, this one is supposed to be on 9th of March. And in fact, we might get a low earlier, or we might get a low a little bit later on. So again, in the same way, just like the price zone, this is approximate. When you look at physically with an eye, it seemed to give you some kind of proportion. That's basically what I'm trying to indicate. So both in terms of time and in terms of price levels, their general indication, and in terms of the price action, it's a general shape of zigzag that we are expecting, and not necessarily the exact path. The path will not follow this. You can be absolutely 100+% sure that the price action will not hit this bottom and then follow this particular line. And I'm expecting, if this is wave A and this one becomes a wave B in pink, then what I'm expecting is this leg should be a very strong 5-wave to the upside. That would be clear. However, if if all of this is not on A, but it becomes a W, just like this one is W, become W, then we are expecting this to be W, X, and Y. So this is the larger W. These are smaller range. So this become a larger Y. Then we're expecting W, X, and Y. So it's the larger. So in other words, we would then finish up this one here as larger W. And say, make that one say a blue, say, for example, larger W. We could have this one here as a larger X. And then we would get a larger Y. Now, in that particular situation, we might not get a clear five-way move to the upside. We might get another zigzag in there. Okay. So, you know, in terms of the price action, I'm expecting this one to decline. Then we have a strong leg up. But that strong leg should be similar to that, because you know there is a symmetry in that sense. So clarifying that, let me now explain to you how I approach technical analysis. I do not, because that's the other point on here we are looking at, when I indicate what the analysis is and what is not, that's how you should interpret it. But the way I approach it is, as you see on this chart and on several other charts, for example, one of the other charts that we've been sharing, this chart here, this one, you see, you'll see like channels, like common channel everybody uses, trend lines, horizontal, you know, support and support and resistance. I use Fibonacci because that helps me to, for example, over here, what I've done is I've taken this leg, the length of this leg, and applied it to here, and the common relationship should be 100%. But in this case, 100% is so low. In fact, you know, it's almost dropping down to 35. So I don't think that looks reasonable. So what I've done then is I put in 78%. Well, we've had 78% already hit. So the next level after that is 88.6% relationship of that leg. So that could be somewhere in the region of 100. You know, it could be 100, it could be 120, could be a little bit lower down, maybe 80 or 90, but approximately that sort of level, right? And then if you use this channel, and this is on a log scale, as you'll see here, log scale, if you use a channel, then it seems like the 88.6% and this channel line seem to come into that kind of a zone. So like everybody, I use, you know, channels, I use trend lines, I use horizontal support and resistance. And then I use Fibonacci to help me, and the Fibonacci should be let me just clarify. Fibonacci, you can't, for example, there are several ways of putting Fibonacci relationship on a chart. Some people will say, for example, measure this leg and then apply it from the height of that. So that's one way of putting it. So in other words, if this is 100% and you put it there, then say the next one will be 127%, 138%, 161.8%, that sort of thing. So if you were to do that, for example, then you will get something like this, the other way around. Okay, so we have 100% here. And then the next level for that one would be like 127%. Another one could be 138%. Then common like 1.6, and there are other minor levels. So if you did that, then you would expect 127%. Well, that fell in line with my 78%. Measured that leg from there. Then 138% is not quite exact, but it's falling in approximate zone of 88.6%. So that is one way of putting Fibonacci relationship, and many use that. There's nothing wrong. And this Fibonacci relationship that you see, again, one must never think that it's an absolute level. It could be, but sometimes it might not quite get there. Sometimes it might overshoot. Sometimes you might get a price actually closing low and then reversing. Sometimes you might just get a spike low, and then come, depending on what time frame you're looking at, spike low and then never closing below that level. Okay, but one should never look for an absolute level. It should, all of these, every technical analysis should be an approximate zone. That zone could be depending on the actual volatility of this instrument that you are analyzing. It could be anything from 5-6% on either side. Now for Bitcoin, that could be big. You know, 10% on Bitcoin, 5% up, 5% down, 10% on Bitcoin could be substantial. But in overall scheme of things, it's not. It is, you know, relative zones. So that's one way of putting Fibonacci relationship. But the common way in which the Elliott Wave people or practitioners apply Fibonacci is they measure the length of the wave in this particular cycle. So you measure the length of that wave and apply it from where you think the next leg is beginning. So we have this retracement up. So next leg is beginning from there. And that would be the correct way to apply Fibonacci relationship from Elliott Wave practitioner's point of view. But nothing wrong with either of them. You know, sometimes one will work absolutely brilliant and the other one might be slightly out. But as I say, if you're not looking for an absolute level, then either of these things will work. There are some levels in between, but then you can get really bogged down into some minor moves, and I don't think it's worth focusing that closely. So that's why I use Fibonacci relationship. If you're in a cycle, sometimes what many people do is they will pick up like a clone of the price of this one and then apply it on there. You know, many technical analyst people have tried to do that. And again, you might find that, you know, sometimes you get almost like an exact replica, but it's very rare. You can go back and test this and you'll find that sometimes initially looks like it's following absolute, you know, letter to the T to that price. So if you applied this one from the top of that, for a while you might think, okay, we had leg down, we had the squiggle right retracement. Here we had leg down, little squiggle retracement. Then, you know, you begin to think, okay, it's going to unfold like that. So many people try and anticipate this price subsequent following same route. But if you did that now historically, you'll find it didn't follow that. So I always have a problem in using any clone price piece applied on certain pivot in order to propagate where it will go. Just like, you know, we are here now. So many people will probably say, okay, what we'll do is we will clone this price and put it over there, right? You know, it might follow the price similar. But as we already said, the relationships are not exactly 100%. So it could be that, you know, even if it did replicate that, it might be that this is 100%. This one might only be 127%. So the actual swing will vary in size. Or it could be 61.8%, in which case it will be very small. So you can never be absolutely sure that even if it did replicate the exact pattern, that the timing and the price move will be the same. So I would refrain from doing that. But general Fibonacci relationship is good. And then if you look at visually, you might visually see that this box looks very similar to that. And then you can say that maybe if we have this zigzag up, we should expect something similar on here. Okay? So that's reasonable to expect, but don't expect an exact proportion both in time and price to be replicated here. That never happens. Just like over here, I'm looking for a move down, but in comparison to the rest of them, this might be small. It might not even be as big as this. So again, if I was to pick this up and put it over here, it won't necessarily give me an exact pattern. So that particular approach, I do not subscribe to, but I have no problem or issue with anybody else if they feel comfortable in following that. So, you know, having outlined the general approach, I use some, you know, moving averages. So for example, on this one, I've got 200 period moving average. You can see currently seems to be, and again, just like the lines, moving average is not an absolute. Sometimes it will actually be fairly close, but sometimes it might not get there. Sometimes it might overshoot. So it's I will always look at all of these things as a general zone rather than an absolute level. Okay, so with that aside, you know, the major overlay on all of my analysis where clear is Elliott Wave. And the reason why I have Elliott Wave is because I think it does actually give you a structure, both in terms of what has happened and based on that, what is likely to happen. No 100% guarantee of any of these technical analysis or in fact any other form of analysis. If people, for example, have an in-depth knowledge of fundamental analysis or detailed knowledge of a particular industry, you know, they cannot give you an exact path. So there is no way of knowing exactly how price will unfold, but you need to have a general concept, general, you know, framework. If you're driving on the road, you need to know approximately where the curb is, so you don't start driving onto a pedestrian footpath. Neither would you want to veer so far off to the other side where you're actually going onto the path of an oncoming traffic from the other direction. So you want a general layout. So you need a mark where the curb is, and you need a general a central line mark where the two directional lines are divided to give you a demarcation, and then you will place your vehicle as you drive. So in the same way, I expect that all of these technical analyses, moving averages, trend lines, Fibonacci's, all of these, they are an approximate zone where you're expecting certain things and you look out for that. And based on what you see at the time when the price gets there, then you plan your trade accordingly. So even though if I'm placing this particular move, you cannot trade off that because, you know, before it gets there, it might come down a bit further. And, you know, you will have an adverse drawdown and your account might not be able to handle that, or your risk tolerance, you yourself might not be able to handle that. And it would be inappropriate because we might find that, you know, I expected this particular move and it never happens and price actually plummets down. So you'll be completely exhausted. Your account will blow, or you will sustain a very damaging capital loss. So, you know, charting is one aspect of where you think price is going to go, but price will not go there just because you put a line up there. So you could be, I could be completely wrong. For example, here, I'm expecting the price to drop, and we might actually find that this price just rockets straight up, you know? So you cannot put your trade based on that. And just because I put a chart up, you know, months ahead, and then somebody goes back and looks at that chart and plays a play button and find that, you know, I expected a low to here, but price never got there and price continues straight up. So I was wrong. Well, when people start doing that, they're, I think, missing the point because they themselves have not put out a chart analysis outlining where the price is going to go. So they would be making an unfair comparison. But secondly, what I am seeing, what might happen is based on what I have, you know, already have on my chart and based on my interpretation of that. So if I think that this is a zigzag, that's my interpretation. It may not be a zigzag. It might actually finish up with a, you know, five clear move to the downside or a five clear move to the upside. So if I was only expecting a zigzag, for example, like here, it might not actually become a zigzag. We might actually get a little lower and another leg up. It might actually become five wave move to the upside. So it's how I interpret. My interpretation could be wrong, but the based on the interpretation I have made of the existing price, I am now anticipating something in the future. And if the price doesn't do that, my trade does not follow line just because I have put a line up there. I will interpret when the price begins to tell me whether I am wrong or whether I am correct. And I will then plan my trade accordingly. If, however, I was expecting a reversal here, but it didn't, and it goes up there, I will then review and say, I did expect a reversal at this level. It didn't reverse. They got up there. But is there anything in that piece that tells me that something has changed? Right. So based on that, if I see that I was expecting within this minor move that, say, for example, I was expecting a zigzag like this one, minor one, retracement, another one up. You see, if I was expecting that before this reversal and it never got there, then I will see if the price got up here, has anything changed? Is, for example, this zigzag still the same zigzag, except that we happen to have a slightly longer leg? Or is within here, we have a potential change in the price structure, i.e. Is in fact, let me just delete this one and I'll change the color so you can see the difference between what I'm trying to do. So, you know, say for example, I was expecting a zigzag, but instead of a zigzag, has price done something different? For example, I was expecting that, right? But instead, has the price actually done something different like this, right? And if it has, instead of a zigzag, I've got a five-way move up. If it has, then is that significant? You know, where we might get a retracement and then continue higher up like that. Is that likely to happen? Or I expected a zigzag, but nevertheless, we had a five-way move up, but overall, it still doesn't change the fact that we've got a larger, this one is a five-way move up. This one is just a, say, call it a minor three. So we've got a zigzag up to here, retracement, and then five-way move. But overall, it's still a zigzag, and hence, it will reverse, right? So just because I put out a line doesn't mean the price must do exactly the same, and it doesn't mean I have traded that. It means that when the price gets there, I will look at it and see, you know, is the price doing what I'm anticipating? And if it is, then I plan my trade accordingly. If the price hasn't done that, when it gets there, I see if anything has changed. And if something has changed, I will revise my, you know, outcome or expectancy going forward. And everybody does that. And if somebody doesn't, and if somebody goes back to some old chart of somebody that put out 3 months ago and the price hasn't got there and he's done something different, and they come out then in public and say, look, you know, this guy is lost it. He doesn't understand, and look, the price never got where he was expecting. Because nobody does that. Nobody. Whether you are 100% fundamental, you are fundamental and technical analyst, or you have some, you know, some inner grasp of exactly what is happening in the sentiment of the people trading. You know, there are some people who pretend or who assume, and I would suspect that maybe they do even have a special knack for telling where the price is going to go. I doubt, you know, very much if they are able to, you know, predict exactly where the price is going to go and how it's going to get there a week or two or month ahead. You know, I don't know of any system that allows somebody to make that kind of a forecast. But a general forecast, like I've been doing, that is possible, and sometimes it can be fairly accurate. But the main point of this chart is not to tell you exactly where the pie is going to go and which path is going to follow, but a general outline, a general shape, and more to the point, an overall direction. So, for example, in this chart, as you will know, I've been expecting a price to bounce back up to the upper end and then decline. So even if price didn't do exactly what I was telling or expecting, it has, as an outline, followed. And in fact, when we had this low here at 151, that was somewhat of a shocker to me. I didn't expect that spike low to go there. And in fact, because of that, we will now review what has happened and has that changed in a major way, anything else that we have assumed and followed up to leading up to that point. So we'll do that a little later on. So that's just a general explanation of looking at my chart, looking at anybody else's chart, and anticipating whether, you know, this move is likely to happen, or is going to fail, or somebody's got a grasp or not. Okay. So anybody who has actually followed my chart would have known right from early, you know, early part of this correction, I've been saying that we are heading, you know, I was cautious, and by nature I am cautious, and one can't be dogmatic and say this price is going to plummet to 120 at the outset. So my initial cautious view was we're going to get minimum 600 and more likely 400. And I held that for several months, and in fact we did get, we fell even below 400, 380 somewhere here, on an empty GOX. I think it dropped even further, but on this Bitstamp, we had a low here. Then when we moved back up, you know, ever since people have been saying that was the final low, and they've been splicing clones of this onto there to predict higher price and all that. But I've been saying, just because of the way the price went up, that it didn't give me confidence that that was a major low, and that we are now going to go and see a new bullish trend to the upside. So I have maintained bearish trend, and within that, the other aspect to remember is within that you'll see significant move to the upside. You know, in comparison, we had a low here at 250, and we went back up there about 680 somewhere, right? So, you know, it's a significant move from where the price was. So that somebody might say that's a bullish cycle. Well, it might be bullish, but it's a bullish cycle within an overall bearish cycle. You know, so I would call that not a bullish cycle because it confuses. So I would call that retracement phase. So this is the main major cycle to the downside, dominant cycle since November 2013. And that what we've got there is a bearish cycle. And within that, we have a retracement cycle, which could be very strong. And, you know, to somebody who's trading 5-minute chart, it would be bullish because that would be just as big as some of these moves, relatively speaking. But it's not bullish in the sense of a new bullish cycle to the upside. But it is bullish in terms of whatever has happened previously, this one is simply retracing. Likewise, when we had this major decline, again, people were saying that was an ultimate low, and I suggested it was not, and that we had a retracement to the upside. And then we declined and we took out that low and made even lower low. Okay, so like by very nature, I had been expecting a low around about 240, being a cautious. But we went well beyond that. But I have always been saying that, you know, although I'm expecting 240, 120, 100, or even 80 is not out of question. And that still remains on card. It's not gone. It's still hanging there. It might take us some time to get there, but it's not actually out of question. It's not removed. Many people are now saying we will never see 250 again. In the chart yesterday, I observed, and even today, many people are saying we'll never see 250 again. But I can't say that. I can't say we'll never see 250 again. Neither can I say that this price is not going to go to 450. Although I'm expecting about 320 or so, I can't say it'll never get to 400. Somebody might say, well, you said it's going to go to 120 before going to 400. Well, I can't do that because this move up could actually take us to 400 before we drop down to here. So one can never be sure, but I'm expecting a retracement. That retracement simply means as long as this overall phase remains, that the upside is limited to maybe 320, 300. And if it did get wild and we get a poke like this one, we could well get to 400. But it won't change the fact that we are still in a bearish cycle. So those are kind of common things to remember. But you know, in addition to the common trading channel lines, horizontal support resistance, Fibonacci's, moving averages, using indicators, Elliott Wave is like a canvas I wrap everything with wherever it's clear. When it's not clear, then I keep it in the back of my mind. And I rely more on trend lines, RSI or oscillators. And it's all a question of how individuals interpret. For example, many people are now saying we've got potential bullish crossover. Well, we did have a bullish crossover of MACD over here, you know, but see where the price went. You know, then we had another bullish crossover over here, but that didn't change. So, you know, even interpreting these indicators, you know, One could anticipate a bullish move, but it doesn't mean just because it's a bullish crossover that this is now going to go and retest the all-time high. That would be foolish. And if it was not, you would not be able to trade that because, you know, before it moves to where you're expecting, what if you have an adverse move against you, which you can't handle in your account? You know, your account can't handle that kind of adverse drawdown. So you can't trade off that. So, you know, why make up a comment which doesn't appear logical? So these are all probabilities. And that's at the end of the day, what we are looking at. But so far, I think if you're reasonable, you will go back onto my charts. And even if my charts where they sometimes said it'll go to 320 and it didn't, and we stopped at 400, leaving those aside, overall, I've stayed on the right side of the trend. And the right side of the trend is we are in a bearish cycle. This bearish cycle is not over yet. There's a lot more to come. And we'll go into what might come in a moment. So we've covered briefly the technical approach I use. I don't build into that any fundamental, which I don't understand. And likewise, I have no idea how much of that fundamental actually is reflected in the existing price and how much of it has yet to be accounted for in the price unfolding in time to come. Okay, so that's one reason why I don't necessarily get too bogged down with fundamentals. But also, some of the fundamentals, I have no concept. I don't understand it enough. I'm not just saying this because of the Bitcoin, which is very, very difficult for me to understand all the infrastructure and all these other comments that I read other traders make in the chat. You know, I'm not ashamed to let you know that I don't really understand. You know, for me, if you make a very crude comparison, it will be like somebody saying invention of internet to somebody who's using fax machine in the days to go, you know, in decades go. Back in 1990, when the internet was just coming, I had an internet access, but I used to have a dial-up network where I think the limit was something like 240 kilobytes per minute or something like that. So you can see it's almost non-existent dial-up network where you dial into an internet. But at that time, many people were using faxes and they could not trust email, they could not trust internet. So if you compare, I'm like that. You compare Bitcoin to somebody's using faxes, that's where I am. I'm in that sense, in my concept of or grasp of technicals in terms of technology, I am decades behind compared with many of you. So, you know, I readily admit I don't understand Bitcoin and whole of its structure. And one aspect that really disheartens me when I see is this constant negative things like people, you know, been hacked and the whole exchange got compromised and somebody stole thousands and millions of dollars worth of Bitcoins. You know, that sort of thing tells me that this is just a wild west and it will be a long time before it gets into the main common day acceptance by wider public and commercial organizations. So leaving that aside, even if you were looking at fundamentals in terms of financial fundamental detail like Google and Apple and their financial performances and their earnings and historical earnings and all that kind of thing, I do understand. I have concept, but I don't grasp it. And I think it's difficult because we don't have the data as somebody like me in my position don't have the data that I need that somebody in JP Morgan, for example, or Goldman Sachs would have. So I can't compete on their terms. So for that reason, I don't delve too much into fundamental, but I don't dismiss it because I think sometimes major trend or major turning point happen based on fundamental too. So I am not completely dismissing it. I am on the lookout, but I don't go out of my way looking for fundamentals. So for example, when we were leading up to this November 2013 high, that was as a result of all this Senate hearing and everything else and all the positive news. And that was used to pump this one to the level where it was unsustainable. And ever since, we've never been able to retest that level again. So that was as a result of some kind of fundamental. So I'm not dismissing that. And then maybe some of this spike low sell-off might have been coincident with the fundamental. For example, this high, I remember that was the first auctioning going on. And many people were saying that, why would somebody want to pay high price in auction? So they will try and push the price market down. I didn't think that. I thought that whoever is bidding in that particular auction, they will be looking for like notoriety. People will be looking for name. They'll be looking for publicity to indicate to a wider Bitcoin community that they're big boss, they're big dog in this industry. So they will want their names there. So those people will be looking to bid. And in order to bid and to be successful, obviously you have to bid at a level where you think other people will not bid at. So in very nature of that kind of bidding, people will bid and they'll overpay. And this price actually went up, contrary to what people were saying, that why would somebody want to buy a Bitcoin at that level when in fact market can sell them at a lower level. Well, I don't know at the end what the Bitcoin auctioning successful bid was at that time, but the Draper, was it Draper? Not Draper, sorry, the other chap, I forget the name of the guy. And now you can see why I have problem in tackling fundamentals in detail. I have a poor memory of remembering all these technicals, but I remember this event. So whatever price he paid, And then there was a follow-up press conference. And based on the press conference, the prices started coming down, and kind of body language of that individual and the way he was fiddling with his feet and all that, I anticipated that based on my technical, that was likely top, and he has overpaid. And his body language was telling me that he, effectively he's trapped. And subsequently, although he was saying he's in a, you know, this in a long overhaul, in a long haul, and he's trying to promote this Bitcoin and establish new trading exchanges and whatever else. Well, I don't know what he's done and what he's likely to do, whether these were just a talk or you know, something he had real plan to do. But, you know, I recognize he's overpaid and his body language was telling me he's trapped. We had this decline. And then again, we had another auction. That was again, you know, he apparently, I think, didn't bid or somebody else won. But, you know, these both auctions apparently had similar outcome, similar leg, similar shape. And we've got another leg coming up, another auction coming up. I'm not saying we'll get an exact repeat, but it's likely that we are currently retracing to the upside. It may well be that we might make an intermediate top with a new auction. Or this time it might be different, and the new auction will be such that it will then propel the prices higher. So we'll come on to that. But you know what I'm saying is that fundamentals do have a play over price. So these things I just outlined to you from my short experience with the Bitcoin price. I only got, you know, dealing with Bitcoin charts from about March, April of 2013, but I never published. And I was talking privately with another individual who was interacting with me from FX chart. And he asked me to have a look at the Bitcoin chart. So I was interacting with him on an individual one-to-one basis, but that's approximately where I got involved. So prior to that, I heard of Bitcoin, but I had a completely different concept. I thought Bitcoin mining very hard, and I thought maybe it's like a rare metal like platinum and others, and no wonder people find it hard to mine that. So that was my concept of what Bitcoin was. Somebody told me that you have to mine. So the mining gave me the concept that you have to take a shovel and bucket like the old gold hunters were doing in America, and you have to toil for days to try and get one Bitcoin. You know, but that was not the case, but that's the concept I had. But I got involved here, and I was expecting a price to come down to somewhere about, you know, 60 or just below that, about 60, in order to get involved. But when we never got to 60, and the price just rocketed. So after that, I started following this Bitcoin chart a bit more actively. So from the short memory of my Bitcoin, my experience, fundamentals do have a play, but I don't know exactly how much of that is taken into account and how much is yet to be reflected in the future price. So consequently, I don't dismiss it, but I don't sort of go out of my way looking for them. I don't read endless newspaper articles to try and see what's happening all over the place. Okay, so that aside, let's go into the real piece now. I think we've covered adequately these pieces here, why the trading and technical analysis are different, what I intend to show by my analysis, and how I apply my analysis. And I assume probably something similar like that would be applicable to all technical analysts who publish their charts, other than few who think they are really too wise and they are the best in the world and they know everything and they know exactly where Bitcoin is going to go. Well, I'll leave them to trade their own particular price expectation. But as far as I'm concerned, that's the way I approach my technical analysis. And I think I would at least score a reasonable level. I know maybe 50 plus marks. So, you know, the fact that I have remained on the right side of the Bitcoin trend since November suggests that there is some credence to what I'm saying. Dismiss it if you feel it's inappropriate, because you know this is my analysis, and I have a right to analyze and express my view, or at least form my view for myself. I don't expect anybody else to subscribe to it, but if you think it makes sense, then you can take into account. I don't expect you to trade exactly what I'm telling you, but take into account as you analyze your chart and see if there is anything that complement what I'm saying, or that you have a different outlook and that mine is completely out of place, so then feel free to dismiss it, no problem. Okay, so let's now review on why we have expected this price action with these labels. Ever since I got very actively involved with the Bitcoin community in chat and in publishing my chart, I have been expressing that because of this short time history, and even if I go back to, before I go there, let me just answer a couple of questions very briefly, because there have been questions posed to me, both private messages on TradingView and also by emails and comments left on chat that I published. So one of the comments somebody expressed to me was dollar index. Dollar index, they feel, and I agree to some extent, is that we are likely heading for dollar index either to make a complete reversal or at least make a retracement of this strong leg up. Now, I have no way of knowing at the moment, but the way I'm reasoning is I'm looking at this as a triangle. In technical analysis, commonly, triangle is a congestion. Whenever you break out of the triangle, many people will say the height of the triangle, if you place it from the breakout point, gives you the upside target. So that's possible. So I've indicated that by saying the height of the triangle is this green line, and you can put it on the top from where it broke out, or you can put it from the base from where the actual move started. You can put it from wherever. And as you know, by nature, I am cautious. So I would rather prefer to put it from the base instead of a breakout. But it doesn't matter. Either of them will be fine. If you put it from the base, then I'm expecting this to top around about 100, just about 100. We are not there yet. So it's possible we might get 200. We might not even get 200. We might stop short. Okay, but the other aspect of it is, see here, I said this could be a limiting triangle. So the difference between limiting triangle and a normal triangle is, if I can show you on here, let me go back onto this chart here. So difference between the two is that, and you can then check up other references to satisfy your own particular need for explanation. So if you have two triangles, one of them here like that, they both look absolutely identical. There's no problem at all between the two. So regardless of my drawing, assume that they're both identical. But this is what we are expecting. Okay, so what we're expecting is a price to move up. It doesn't matter how many swings. Okay, so forget the actual swings. I'm just trying to explain to you the difference between the two triangles. So this one, for example, actually breaks out from here, right? And the other one continues almost to the point, you know, to the very tip, like that, okay? So when you draw this line, you'll find that it continues almost right up to the very tip of this triangle. So in my mind, this one would be called a limiting triangle, whereas this one is a normal triangle. The difference is that if you then, for example, measure the total length of this, okay? So you measure total length of this, and on the trading view, I am not sure, because I have not used this Fibonacci time retracement. But say, for example, if this was the full move, right, and you went back and edited that one line. See, this is why I am coordinates. Yeah, this is why I'm not too keen on this, because it simply tells you line one, line two, line three. But suppose, okay, let me put it this way. Instead of line two, say I put in there 0.618, or better still, 0.618, an absolute is, say, 78.6, okay? Ideally, 61% is better, 61.8% is better, but say, okay, so I've got it. So say, for example, And let's do that with both triangles. Okay, so say By the way, I haven't done it, but what we should do is really actually take this line all the way to the very end, where they both meet. Right, so just assume for the time being they meet exactly at that point, right? So what we do now is we put these fibs where the lines end, okay? Now, if the price action has broken out before reaching the 78.6%, okay? So in this case, say even if we had this, it broke out. So we broke out by 61.8% or 78%, then this is less likely to be a limiting triangle, which means that there is no limit specifically. So even if we say this is 1-to-1, like some people will say, put height of the triangle from where it broke, and even it could get there, that would be the minimum. Well, not minimum, but one would expect to be reasonable. Say that could be possibly a minimum target, but it could go to 1.618, it could go to 261.8. So this kind of a breakout doesn't necessarily limit it, but if we have a triangle like this one, where we have a total length of a triangle and it continues into after 78.6%, then it's more likely that this will be a limiting triangle. So limiting triangle means that the upside will be limited possibly by the height of the triangle. So that's why they call it limiting triangle, whereas this one is non-limiting triangle. So this is from common technical analysis point of view. If you're looking at this from Elliott perspective, then both triangles are indicating that the outcome will be a final leg out. So whether that leg happens to be limited by the height of the triangle or whether it goes up to 1.618 or 2.618, doesn't matter. Either way, the resultant move out of the triangle is the last final leg from Elliott wave perspective. So Elliott wave perspective already gives you the idea that your move out of the triangle is the final leg out. So that already gives you an insight into where this price could go. And then second insight would be is if it's a limiting triangle, then chances are you'll be limited by about 100% with the height of this triangle. And if it is non-limited, then the price could go beyond the height of the triangle to maybe like 1.38, 1.618, 200%. Any of those things are possible by common Fibonacci relationship. So that's the difference between the two type of triangles. So going back to this one, I'm saying is a limiting triangle. If this is a limiting triangle, chances are we'll be having a potential top around 100 or maybe before that. My other Elliott wave count tells me that maybe we will go up to about 98 somewhere. But regardless of whether you get 98 or 100, dollar index is likely to pop out there and make a reversal, or we might have a situation where we might get a retracement, maybe something like here, and then have another leg up. Now, I don't know which of the two. Okay, at the moment, coming out of the triangle could be a final leg out. So that tells me this is more likely at the moment from the explanation I gave you on move out of the triangle is terminal or final leg out. So based on that, this is what I'm expecting. But if this happens to be just a first part of this final move up, it's a minor cycle one, retracement cycle two, and then we'll go into a cycle three, four, and five. And in that way, it happens to be a final cycle, but have a five leg in it, then we may head much higher. We could go up to 120 or even higher up. So either of them are possible. But for right now, I'm expecting that maybe around about 98 or maybe upper side of 100, we should be coming down. Other channel lines, you can see possibly a low, high form there. You can also see divergences forming on RSI, on this weekly triangle, weekly time frame rather. Stochastic, normal stochastic is not showing particularly, is not saying that it's now reverse, but is not showing momentum is gathering pace to the upside. It's simply saying now momentum appears to be neutral, meaning that this can continue, grinding higher, but is not showing a strong momentum like it did in the early part of the swing. So as soon as that momentum is over, then at least we expect a retracement. That's the minimum I'm expecting, or a complete reversal. So either side, we don't know exactly where dollar is going to go, but we will expect a retracement. So if that's the case, some people are saying that if it's going to come down, that means Bitcoin is going to explode. Well, it could do, but have a look at this chart. This is the chart here where we have a dollar index on the top, the same dollar index we were looking at, dollar index on the top and the Bitcoin at the bottom. And what I'm trying to show is that whilst the theory says that if the dollar index goes up, that means the dollar strength goes up, then the Bitcoin should come down because it's measured in dollar. Any dollar denominated instrument will suffer if the dollar becomes strong. So that's a normal theory. However, in reality, it doesn't actually bear out that they are always opposite, right? For example, these cyan boxes that I've shown indicate where I think the price did exactly the same as what dollar index was doing. And then there are these minor occasions where dollar index did one thing, but the price did something different. And then you got this magenta where apparently, again, dollar index did one thing and the Bitcoin did the opposite. So over here, dollar index went up, Bitcoin went up. Over here, dollar index came down, Bitcoin more or less went sideways. It didn't necessarily go up and didn't come down. It's approximately sideways. Then again, we have here dollar strength going up, Bitcoin going up. Then here we got Bitcoin, dollar strength going up and down and up, and the Bitcoin doing something similar, but basically just going sideways. So in other words, not exactly in tune and not exactly opposite. And over here we had dollar strength weakening, Bitcoin actually going the other way or sideways. But I think it's going up. So even from here by this blue line, you see that the dollar index came down somewhat and Bitcoin went up. Then in this portion, we had Bitcoin and dollar index both coming down. Dollar index coming down, Bitcoin coming down. Over here, now where the dollar index went really up, Bitcoin came down. So you can see that they're not exactly always in sync. They don't necessarily always do opposite. So it would be not reasonable to assume that if the dollar index was to come down over here, that Bitcoin would explode to the upside. And one of the reasons for that is because the dollar index, when it moves, the magnitude of its move in comparison to the amplitude or fluctuation of Bitcoin is so big that sometimes it's almost impossible to make an exact comparison. But you can see that even just being very crudely and very sort of cursory glance at this chart suggests that there are times when the both of them are going up. And you'll find similarly, when dollar index was going up in certain time frame, gold was going up. And when dollar index was coming down, gold was coming down. So they don't always necessarily go opposite to each other. That's all I'm trying to say. So even if dollar index was coming down, we could find that Bitcoin could actually come down even further, or Bitcoin could just go sideways and not really benefit from dollar weakness. It might just go sideways. So any of those things are possible. They don't have such a deeper insight. So I would not spend too much time agonizing on where dollar is going, because whilst it is measured in dollar, Bitcoin has a different dynamics and it's got different behavior. And like all instruments, sometimes they'll do exactly what dollar index is doing. They're both becoming strong. At other times, both becoming weak. And at some times, they're doing their own thing. So they don't help necessarily to help us in getting longer term perspective. So that aside, it is still an idea to keep an eye on it, not completely dismiss it, but don't assume just because dollar index weakening, this is going to go and retest new all time high. That's not going to happen. It is not borne out by the price action relationship in the previous period leading up to November 2013. So I'll close that, and I will also close the chart we were looking at, the limiting chart. Where is, if I can get my hand on it, this one here. Okay, so I get less confused. But one thing we will come back to is the relationship that the Bitcoin has with S&P 500. Like we've seen here, you've seen this particular chart where again, there are times when they'll appear out of sync, But in majority of the cases, wherever the Bitcoin went up, here you've got S&P 500 going up. Bitcoin in some kind of a triangle or sideways congestion, S&P doing almost something similar, not doing major different. I mean, it went up and it came down, but broadly speaking, in that period, they were neutral, both moving sideways. Then again, S&P 500 carried on, generally speaking, Bitcoin went up. And then ever since here, they've been out of sync, where Bitcoin is making lower, lower, and lower highs in repeat cycle, whereas the S&P 500 has continued to generally go up. So now we are seeing a major diversion between the two since the November 2013 high in Bitcoin. But up until then, they've been going up together. And even after that, although this one is in a bear cycle, so it's creating lower highs and lower lows, you can see S&P 500 going up. But there are times when they're still going from this low, for example, from April, Bitcoin went up, S&P 500 went up. Then the Bitcoin came down. S&P 500 had a period of sideways to weaker. I mean, it sort of moved sideways and it had a major drop. And that drop also lined up with the drop in Bitcoin. Then again, we had a rally in the S&P 500. We had a sort of a rally in Bitcoin. So even then, the swings are lining up very well with S&P 500. So it would be worth looking at S&P 500 because it's got a longer time history in comparison to Bitcoin to show where S&P 500 is heading. And if S&P 500 is appearing to head to the stratosphere, then it's possible for Bitcoin maybe to gather enough strength to go back and at least retest November 2013 high or maybe go on to a new higher high. But if the S&P 500 over a longer term is now weakening and is likely to correct in a noticeable, substantial way, then it's possible that Bitcoin will struggle to go back and retest a new all-time high. So that's a conclusion we can draw just by looking at a common relationship between the two. And we will come back to S&P 500 a little later on. But so let now switch back to this cycle we were looking at. So we were looking at this cycle, reviewing the count. So on this agenda, we've looked at relationship with USD dollar and S&P 500. Now the initial assumption of the wave count, that's what we are looking at. So we're looking at this move, and I label that, and it doesn't matter whether I use a square bracket or just a double bracket or anything, but simply to suggest that may be the cycle, major cycle one, major cycle two, then we've got this major cycle three. And within that major cycle three, I think we've got intermediate cycle one and two. And I've assumed that this was three, because within it, we've got a minor one, two, three, four, and five. So that's a minor cycle three. And we are looking at minor cycle four to correct before we go in to complete that minor cycle five, so that we would then have this larger wave three complete. That's what we've been following and we've been assuming. So this expectation is based on what we have assumed this to be major cycle one, two, and in which case we are going for three. And if we are not correct, so far it has actually done us favor because we were able to identify this well. And you know, many people were expecting low here, but based on this cycle, we were saying that the low is not likely to happen before the middle of 2014, and in fact it didn't. Then we revised it and we said it's not going to happen before late 2014 to maybe early 2015. So far it has served us well, but now we are in an area where it appears to be going well beyond this trend channel we defined. And many of them, not just me, many of them have put this trend line on and were expecting that to hold. So likewise, I was expecting it to hold with a possible lower about 240. But now we have clearly dropped down. And this drop down cannot be minor. It's not something insignificant, in other words. Because when I'm looking at any trend lines and things, I, as I've said earlier, I look at a zone. So even if it had a minor breach, I would not necessarily discount the fact that it is still within that channel. And even now, it's not completely out of place to say that maybe it has a minor breach overall and it will reclaim that channel. It's still possible for it to do that. But the breach is not just incidental. It's not just minor. It could be or it is looking to be more than just a minor breach. Okay, so when people are putting trend lines on, and they will, for example, like over here on the chart at the bottom, they will put this RSI trend line on, and they'll be looking at that, and they'll be seeing, look, that RSI trend line is broken. Well, it's broken, but supposing if the price turned down, this also could turn down, right? This is nothing, just because it went up tiny little bit, it doesn't mean that it's completely out of the danger zone. That could happen because all of these swings are such that your trend line, do I draw a trend line from there? Do I draw a trend line from here? Or do I draw a trend line from there? You know, where do I draw the trend line? So, you know, if I draw it from here, it's got a long way to go. If I draw it from here, then maybe it's still within a trend line. Okay, so it all depends. But then somebody will say, well, you know, you're missing this one out. So if I put a trend line on that, then yeah, it looks like a trend line is broken. So you mustn't spend hours on end trying to say this is broken and this is significant. And just a break doesn't mean that we are in a new trend. You know, you could be on the lookout for a new trend, but it doesn't necessarily confirm that we're in a new trend. Just as much as we have fallen well below, because if this is breaching the downtrend line, then what about this price action being completely below for several? This is the weekly chart. So we are looking at, you know, even if you don't count this one, the December, last week of December, then the first week of January, ever since the January, we closed below the trend line. And even if you excuse that, then definitely from the second week in January, we've been down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 weeks and counting. 7 weeks and counting is almost like 2 months. So that, I think, is a significant. As I said, you know, I don't, or rather, let me rephrase that. I'm not saying that it's impossible for this price action to reclaim the channel. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying, it is significant. So now, what could happen, instead of this one reclaiming the channel, we might actually finish up this one coming back and kissing the channel and then dropping off even further. So there are two possible outcomes. We could have this one retest the broken. People say, you know, support broken, going back up, horizontal support broken, and it's retesting the broken support. It could go back and do a kiss to the rising trend line that it broke, and then it could come down. So that could one, or it could really get strong, gather the momentum, and reclaim the channel. So both outcomes are possible. But, you know, which one of them is likely? Well, so far, this, you know, reclaiming the channel is likely if the assumed counts are correct. If the assumed counts are incorrect, then chances are that reclaiming channel is less likely. In other words, even if it doesn't drop very far, we might actually spend more time in this zone here. Right? If our counts are not correct, we made an assumption. And that's the only thing a technical analyst can do. It can make certain assumption because we don't have decade-long price history of Bitcoin. So we can only start from wherever the first, you know, price bar is plotted on the chart. So you make a certain assumption. And based on that assumption, you know, we've been following price action, but it's possible that that assumption could be wrong. Okay. So let's see if the assumptions are right or wrong. Or could we be having a second? So this could be one option. But then, you know, behind that, we have a second possibility. So we are not completely going to be caught by surprise, okay? And then in terms of time symmetry, if you look at the overall price action from this low, it was approximately 106 bars. So I've been suggesting that on a time symmetry basis, you know, if we have a 50% of that Fibonacci, then time symmetry wise, we won't see a low. That was one of the reasons why I said we won't see a low until we get probably back end of December. If we had a time relationship of 61.8%, then that is suggesting a possible low around end of February. Well, we are at the end of February now, and we haven't got the low. So this time relationship might not hold. If it has become one-to-one relationship, then I think one-to-one relationship on this one, you'll see we are looking at possibly back end of December 2015. So, you know, if we don't reclaim that trend channel and gather momentum the upside, then we'll do something. which would be different from everybody what they're expecting. So we could actually get, instead of having the low, final low, we could actually get some messy sideways action in here. Upside of this one, I don't know exactly where. It could be capped by about 360 or 380, maybe 400. It could be capped, and it could do some messy thing in this area for a long time to come, back end of December. And this back end of December is not a forecast. It's simply saying if we have a time symmetry based on that, that's where we are likely to go. But if we have 78%, this one is 160 bars, so measuring from the high, 78% means that, you know, even if we don't do this messy, it's unlikely we would see a significant low before the July 2015. So that's just on the time symmetry basis. And that is on the assumption that our wave counts are no longer correct, because a lot of price action below the trend channel means that our counts are not correct. Minor breaches are allowed, but if you get a significant breach lasting like several months, then chances are our counts are not correct. We've got some different counts going on, and only price will help us to identify which of these they are. And changing our mind or adjusting our analysis is not wrong. Anybody suggesting that is, you know, everything we've said is wrong just because they've changed something, that individual need to re-examine their logical thinking. You know, the whole aspect of trend analysis or price analysis is, as we get new price, we take that into account and see if it's still holding to the structure we are expecting. If it's not, then we have to review it and then, you know, adjust accordingly. Now, that adjustment sometimes could happen once every 3 months, or it could be within a week. You might have to change your mind. And just because you change your mind within a week, any individual coming back and saying, oh, you changed your mind, your analysis is fickle, then I think that individual need to go back and re-examine his or her reasoning behind it as to why they feel that way. Is it just simply to have a stab at somebody, or are they really serious about it? Okay, but let's see if these counts are correct or wrong. Now, some of you know this chart, which is based on some kind of I don't fully understand it, but it's been given to me, so I'm working with it. They're saying to me that it's derived from some kind of a gold, is a gold year. So I don't know how they've done it, but they've priced something gold and Bitcoin, okay? And again, I'm assuming that whatever they've done, they know what they're doing, so I'm going to go and use that. So assuming that this was the net result of them splicing the Bitcoin price with gold or some kind of derivative or something, in some way to tell me that beyond this high, which is what I've got on here, beyond that high, there was some price action earlier. So I'm assuming that is correct. So if that's correct, then previously we were saying that this wave high was a major wave one, and then this as a major wave two, then we could still be in a major wave three. However, the price action below that trend channel, which identified this cycle, is now causing me to review whether we are actually in that major wave three. Or has something else happened? Has something, for example, like using the same chart as an alternative, something like this has happened, where we've got, you know, even before this chart is plotted, we've got possibly some move up. And this might be at a very, very early stage, maybe, you know, very first time somebody started mining Bitcoin, or when it was first invented, and it wasn't traded, and it was mainly amongst the miners. So if there was something like that, supposing we had a leg up and we had a retracement, and then we've got this price derived from some means. So maybe we've got major cycle wave one as an alternative, major cycle wave two, which is the low of that starting point of the chart, then this one could be wave three, and it would follow the logic, because the wave three is supposed to have a stronger price action. So this one might not be as sharp as I'm suggesting. It might be something like this. Wave three is supposed to be stronger. So if you put a trend line marking out that, then it's possible that the rate of price rising or the steepness of this trend line marking that price is steeper than what we had over here. So then it is possible that that wave high on our previous chart we are seeing is one, it might not be one, it might actually be wave three. Then we've got a wave four bottom, and then we are in a wave five. And if that is the case, then we could have an intermediate cycle wave one, intermediate cycle wave two, and then we've got intermediate cycle wave three. Then it's possible we could do an intermediate cycle wave four and go up to complete. So then we could go on to do an intermediate cycle wave five to the top. So that's possible. So in other words, assuming that high we saw on this other chart is in fact not one, but it is actually larger cycle wave three. Then we go to lows of wave four and we're in a five. So still remain that this one is intermediate cycle in bracket four to go up and complete the five wave. So that's one possibility. Or alternately, we may have a situation where we got something like this, where in fact we have one, two, three, four, and that actually being five. In other words, entire five wave cycle is complete. Okay, now if that's the case, then what we would have, this is a daily chart. Can I use a monthly chart? I can, but I'm not sure if a monthly chart will actually show me a lot more detail than what we see on a daily chart, simply because the price history don't take us back that far. So I think monthly is not gonna show us the detail we are looking at. So I'll continue with this daily chart. So let me explain. If we have this going on, then we've got this major one. And again, this is assumption. See, that's what I'm saying, assuming, okay? I have no idea, but I'm assuming. So based on that assumption, if I see that is one and this is two, then we've got three, four, and five. Then this five can be like this here, which is an ending diagonal where every swing have three. So here, for example, this one, not very clear, but if you drop down, you'll probably see this one have like a three swing, wave one, wave two, and then we got three swing to wave three, four, and possibly three swing back up there to wave five, and in which case, this top that we saw in November 2013 is actually a top of this entire cycle. If it is a top of the entire cycle, then we may not see a retest of that level for several years. You know, 2015 that I was saying on this other one, 2015 on this other one is probably not likely. It is highly probable that we might actually go into some kind of a very big sideways correction. So what kind of a correction can we have? One of the users is saying that a monthly chart, well, let me, and the other problem is that I'm using Bitstamp. I know there was some price history on empty gox, but the empty gox is no longer offering any further price, is closed, so it's no more price data. But even if I was to go on to the monthly on this one, let me see. Save as, copy, and say monthly. I'm not sure if this will actually show anything, but let me just do that whilst we're at it. Okay, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna clear off all the analysis on this one, all drawing tools. Okay, now if I was to change that to monthly, you see, the other thing is, somebody just posted there, see, I've got in log scale. If I did it in this one, then I will get the chart he's posting, you see? I will get that chart he's posting, but then, you know, my eyes are not good enough really to see what's happened in this area. I don't know how and what happened in that area actually relates to subsequent price. And that's the reason why, let me just comment on this log scale or linear or an arithmetic scale, okay? When you're looking at some price action like this one, where, you know, it has multiplied several times, like a factor of 4 and 5 and 10 and more, then really you can't compare any of these or do a sensible analysis unless you go onto log scale. However, if the price change in the period that you are analyzing, so if I go back to the normal, so if you, for example, are only analyzing this area here, if you're only analyzing, I think I slipped up. Let me try and do that again. Okay, so if you're only analyzing this area, then you might get away. But even then, I think the difference is too big, because over here, you're looking at nearly 1,200. Down here, you're looking at nearly 200. So, you know, the difference between the price of the two is more than 3 or 4 times the factor of each other. So this one here need to multiply by 4 in order for me to even get 800. So this is like six times the factor. So when you look at that, it becomes difficult really to make sense of what's happening in this lower end in relation to what happened over there, or conversely, what happened over there, how it relates to price action here. So if you were using this one on a linear scale, for example, and I didn't go into the monthly, but if I went to the monthly, what will I see? I'm not sure I'll see anything incredibly. Yeah, see, I don't really see very much. I mean, you know, nothing to compare, nothing really to analyze. So I will ignore monthly or weekly, because neither of them, simply because the length of price under consideration you're talking at, you see this one price starting from here, which is beginning, even if you were to count the whole of 2010, then you're only looking at, you know, 4 or 5 year of price history. So that element can be adequately addressed within either a weekly chart or daily chart. And in my case, I think I'm happy at the moment to stick to the daily chart for what we are looking at, okay? But also because of the change in the price over the period, I have no option but to look at it on a log scale, because now I can see what happened over here, which previously my eyes were not able to differentiate. See, we had a swing, you know, it was a flat line almost from the chart previously, but now I can see that, you know, there's a definite structure, and how that structure or swing and subsequent price action might be related either by fractal in terms of price pattern or by Fibonacci relationship. Okay, so I'll continue with this one now. So this one is no use to us anymore. So we're back to this one now. So we have two possible possibilities. In addition to here, now we are, it's like, you know, hanging on the cliff by your fingertips to say that this is going to work. You know, sometimes I've had individuals debate with me, and they say previously, look, they drew a trend line from here, and there's a minor breach, and they say that trend line is broken, we are now to the upside. So there were people agonizing and debating with me, almost to the point of embarrassment or calling some abusive names. They were debating with me that this trend is over. So it's not over. And generally speaking, if the trend is there, why should somebody have to put a microscope on to try and demonstrate that that particular line has just gone, you know, 1 cent above where it is? If it's a trend, you know, you should be able to see by naked eye. You shouldn't need a microscope. However, when we see a breach like this one, that is significant in a sense that we might ignore it if this price reclaims the trend channel. But if it doesn't, then it's subsequently, you know, continue to do something different, then that breach so far to me is significant. So if it reclaims the channel, then I am all for what I've said here. If it doesn't reclaim the channel, then I am now reviewing this count, and I'm going to be reviewing this count based on this chart. And on this chart, we have a possibility that November high is actually a major high. That's one. Second one is that November high is actually an intermediate cycle wave three high, and we are still in a cycle four, just like we are saying here, cycle four, but that cycle four is not of this wave three, but rather that cycle four is the final leg up to complete this major wave five there. So we have major wave five finished here, or we will still have a major wave five once this cycle is complete. So really speaking, the key, and I've demonstrated how this could be a wave five with a final five wave completing, because on this, it's not very clear, but it looks like it could be like a gentle contracting wedge, we say rising wedge, and in Elliott wave, that rising wedge is termed as ending diagonal, and in ending diagonal, you could have each of these swings made up of three swings. So the first one, you got three swing, like I explained, we got a three swing, retracement three swing back, then you get another three swing, just like here, retracement back, and then again another three swing. So this is a possibility on the basis that we have a final wave five completed in November high. So the conclusion we would reach is that if that is correct, then we will not see this high being retested for a long, 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 long time. Not just 2014, probably not even 2015, maybe sometime later. And in which case, there is nothing to stop this price retracing a lot lower. You know, if we are talking about, you know, we've said previously it could drop down to about 80. And the only reason why I said 80, and I'll explain that on a chart from the Elliott Wave textbook kind of a chart, but the only reason I said, you know, 80 could be feasible or even 60 is because that's where the low of wave four was, of a one cycle degree lower. So if this cycle was whatever cycle, then the one cycle degree lower wave four was there. So it's possible that this price could actually drop there in some, it doesn't mean it'll drop there in a one straight go. It could do whole sort of messy thing here, then come down. But eventually price could go to drop there, or we could possibly just continue much like this chart here, is that we could go back and retest 300 and then do a zigzag down back towards 100 or 120 or maybe even 80. We could do that and complete this intermediate cycle wave four. Then there is a chance that we could go up. If it's likely to do that, then the reasonable thing based on this time symmetry, and I'm not saying that this time symmetry is correct, it's simply putting it out on the field, then see what happens when the price gets there. So simply projecting the time it took from this low to reach its significant high, it took 106 bars. So placing that, doing 78% Fibonacci, 8% Fibonacci, and 100% Fibonacci. So like those are three common Fibonacci levels. So this one is already out of question because it's not from the low. We might actually form a high and then drop, so that might still be relevant. But 78% is possible, or 100% is possible. If it's 100% possible, then most likely this is not a wave four. Then a weight swings to this being a significant wave five top. If we go much longer, because the breach below the trend becomes too significant both in time and price. If we spend almost a whole year below that trend channel, then you can rest assured that that top was a major wave five top. And so we will now spend several years doing choppy up and down, eventually forming a low from where we can. So that major wave five becomes a wave one of a much larger degree cycle. So we would then be spending a wave two in this area, doing all sorts of things before finally forming the low of a major cycle wave two, then going off in a major cycle wave three. But that will take a long time. Based on this one, we are looking at back end of December. But you know, you could have 100%, we could have 138% or 161%. So we could even go into 2016 doing what we need to do to complete this. If this was ultimate wave 5, and therefore it becomes a next cycle up, it could. So if I do next cycle up, and what I'll do is I'll put it in a big double bracket. I'll put in a double square bracket 1. Okay, so we could have that. And then somewhere here, I don't know exactly where, but we could have, wave 2. Right? So none of this will happen, but we'll be doing some kind of complex correction. So if it's a complex correction, including the correction from 2013 high, what kind of a correction are we in? Well, to illustrate, these are typical kind of correction. The only one I've not got there, in fact, I do, but it's lower down, is this triangle. Okay, there are several different makeup of triangle, but overall, there are triangle which are continuation triangle. If the market is bullish, then we get a triangle. You know, and we talked about a triangle being a terminal. So whatever comes out of the triangle normally is the final leg up. Well, at the moment, we are not in any of these kind of triangle, whether it's expanding or contracting triangle. We're in a bear trend, so we are not again in any of these bearish configuration of triangle, okay, as an entire cycle. But what we, so in other words, if we go back onto this chart here, whatever has happened from there doesn't resemble in its entirety to any of those triangles. There may be a smaller section of within that triangle or within that price action where there may be some triangle, but as an overall price action since then is not resembling any of those triangles. So for the time being, we'll ignore them. So what other alternatives are there? Well, there could be this alternative. And in this alternative, and basically it's like a jigsaw puzzle, or if any of you have ever played a Lego when you were young, you know, you pick up a pieces of Lego, you put something together, you simply put in different pieces to make up a shape. So any of this shape, you can actually pick up and you can join them at the end of the beginning or end of these other ones, and it will give you like a complex correction, complex kind of a sequence like you see over here. But all in general concept is we get a zigzag down, a zigzag back up, and then a 5-wave cycle down. And the reason why that 5-wave cycle down is because that is the last leg of the complete correction. So until we get a 5-wave cycle down somehow, somewhere, we can't actually see an end to the correction. So that's one thing to note. So if you go back to this chart, in this chart here, there have been many different attempts to label these, including myself. I have alternated from labeling some as 1 and some as W and some as X. So, you know, like everybody else, I've also tried, as we get a new price action, I've tried, but eventually I've settled on this one, which has stuck with me now for a good number of months. However, based on the other chart, you see, if, for example, we had this zigzag down to A, zigzag up to B, then we expect a 5-wave cycle down, right? So that would resemble this corrective pattern here. Now, in this particular drawing, they've done it so that it is like a horizontal. So in other words, the height of the B and the low of the C are similar to the low of the A and beginning of this correction. They've done that, but you could have that kind of a zigzag. Still at this cycle, but this one is compressed to the down. So you get A, B, and C. And only difference is that in this wave A, you could have this zigzag. So say, assuming we have that on our chart, assuming we have this ABC zigzag, so we got, you know, A, B, and C to this December low, and if we went back up in a zigzag, so that's a high, so we call that wave B, then we could expect a wave C. Now wave C must have a 5-wave, and hence I am anticipating or had anticipated that this is possibly a 5-wave. 5-wave meaning that we have a triangle, like a narrowing triangle. And remember, as we made a comment before, that a rising wedge could be the end of a triangle. So in the case of this one, we were saying the rising edge is end of this cycle move here. Okay, so if this is a potential rising wedge, then in this case we have a dropping rising wedge, and at the moment it's not so significantly, it's more, it is still narrowing. If you ignore this spike here, this spike we just had here, if you ignore that and draw a trend line, then you can just about see that taking this low and ignoring that, maybe, I don't know, you take a close of the candle on a weekly chart or somewhere in between, but just ignoring the very tip of that, because if you take a very tip of that, then, you know, without sort of getting a measuring rule out, I'm not sure that it would be like a contracting falling wedge. It might still be, but I'm not sure. And as I say, I'm cautious by nature. So I'm going to limit myself to say, okay, let me cheat a little, and let me say that I only take part of that spike, not all of it, to try and make this look like a falling wedge. So it's more of pleasing to the eye rather than the actual measurement. So in that case, we may have this falling wedge. Now in the falling wedge, we can have every swing made up of three swings. So every major swings, like this one. So if you tip this one down, then every swing, that's like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Every swing has a three-wave swing within it. There is a zigzag within it. So what we would expect is that, like this WXY zigzag to give you 1, zigzag again to give you 2. Then you can see a possible zigzag which measures this cycle, retraces, and that cycle. So that could be 3. Before we had that spike low on one of the other chart, on this one, in fact, you saw that I was counting still that as a 1, that as 2, this one as 3, and then I was expecting this 5 to finish here. Okay, so that would still have been falling wedge, like this one here, but I was expecting that to end at 240 area or 220 area somewhere, but I wasn't expecting it to drop to 150. Okay, so because it dropped to 150, I have made a small adjustment. That adjustment now means that where I was expecting a wave 5 low is no longer a wave 5 low, but it's actually a wave 3 low. And is wave 3 low still conforming to falling wedge, where we got this swing as 3 swing, this wave 3 as a 3 swing. We are retracing back, and in a process now, at this moment, we are in progress of that zigzag back up to wave 4. And if that is holding right, then we'll see a zigzag back down like this to complete that 5. Now, I don't know whether that's going to happen now or not. And the reason why I'm not sure, I'm still favoring that. Let me put it that way. I'm favoring that zigzag, and I'm favoring a potential low somewhere in the region of 100, maybe a little bit higher, or possibly around 80 on the downside. I'm favoring that. That is my ideal outcome, I would prefer. But we might not have that anymore. Simply because in order to do that, look at the amount of time we'll be spending below that trend channel. So the only way that could happen is either we are in this one here, where we've had the, in this one here, where we had this as a major wave 3, we are in a major wave 4, and then assuming that we have this like an expanding wave, like a expanding meaning like that. Like that kind of wacky and wild one. So in other words, we would have to draw this one. And if I draw that one with, say, change the color of a blue to, these are just concepts. So I don't know which one of these will eventually happen. I'm just showing you, you know, weeks and months ahead, what might happen, okay? And then we'll let the price show us what is going to happen. So we could have this situation here, right? Triangle there, and then down here is probably something like that, right? So in other words, We had 1, 2, then we had the zigzag up to 3. We're getting back to zigzag down to 4, and then we get another zigzag up. So we won't get a 5-wave up, but we might get a zigzag back to here, and we'll become an expanding triangle. Now, if that happened, it will resemble something like this here, see, like that. But it's a different configuration, but it would you know, end up a triangle like that, like a megaphone, expanding megaphone pattern. Okay, so we are not sure which of these two it will hold out. But for the time being, before we get to that, we are looking at this one here to see what it is resembling. So we've looked at this initial flat, looked at that. It's not exactly that, but it could be this, although it's slightly different because this is a straight zigzag, as you can see. But what we've got is like a twisted one where we get a first leg like a zigzag to W, retracement back up, and we are expecting a 5-wave down made up of like a falling wedge, like this one here, like a falling wedge. So we, for the time being, that's what we are expecting. So that is our first option, which we have been following for some time. And in order for that to happen, we need that to complete around here, maybe middle of 2015, maybe a little bit later. I'm not too much fussed about the time, but we are expecting this one to go up to about 300 somewhere and then drop in a zigzag. That's basically what I'm looking for. I don't care how that zigzag is formed. I'm looking for a zigzag. And the very nature of Bitcoin, as you can see, the first leg of the zigzag sometimes sort of starts off, and then you get really like an exponential move to the downside. Then you get retracement back, you start off gently, and then it collapses. So we may even find this one goes up here and starts off, then collapses, minor retracement, and then repeat the same thing again. So I'm looking for that. If that finishes, then I'm still expecting that maybe this channel has to be adapted somehow. We are no longer able to follow that channel. Maybe then we will have to do something like this here, right? So that would be still possible. And it would allow us to complete this final leg and see a retest of at least November high when this cycle completes, this major cycle completes. And then instead of this being a square 3, we will have this square 5, major 5 there. And then this major 5-wave up is complete. So if we don't see this, if we don't see this low holding in this area, but we see some different price action, then what are we likely to expect? Then I think we are going to go into more like this one, or possibly some combination of that. So on a chart, what it would look like is, on this chart, what it would look like is, and in fact, what I'll do is I'll do a new chart. And in fact, also address why the January low we just saw is not really the final low. Okay, in fact, let me go to that. The January low is not the final low because, you see, we need a 5-wave swing to the upside. And if you look at this on 4-hourly chart, so far what we had from there, so far what we have from there is a zigzag up, zigzag retracement, and then in fact, a zigzag to the upside. So in this cycle, we've got like a double zigzag. We've got the single zigzag to give you, say, a W, X, and then A, B, C to give you second zigzag to go to the top. So we've got double zigzag in there. But instead of a double zigzag, what we should have is a 5-wave pattern. We've not had a 5-wave pattern. And then the price retraced almost the entire part of this zigzag. So that is the reason why I don't think that low is a major low. Even if somebody start arguing that we've got bullish MACD crossover or RSI, or that a trend line drawn on some other scale, like if you go back to this one, And people have to try. So I'm not saying it's wrong, but you see, people will try everything. See, they might go into here, and they might say, no, really, what we should do is we should actually take in that one. And they say, look, price tried to go up, it failed, came back down, and now it's cleared, it's come back, and it's testing the trend line. Now it's going to go up. So, you know, that could be one possibility, but I don't think that's the case. So the trend line can be drawn from anywhere. Nevertheless, based on this count that I just showed you, that low we are looking at is not the final low. So somewhere along the line, whatever happens, somewhere along the line, we will come back and this low will not be the final low. It will be taken out. Whether it's taken out in next couple of weeks or it's taken out in another 6 or 7 months or 8 months, I've no idea. But for the time being, if it remains within this defined falling wedge pattern, then it's possible that we may accommodate that by changing the trend line, changing the trend line from this support line here to where I've just approximately drawn, changing that trend line to match what the price is telling us. But we will take out that low in the next few months and still remain within a potential falling wedge. So if you were to draw that falling wedge on this linear scale, it would look like something like this one. But then you're missing, well, say, okay, we draw that, draw it like that, okay? So it's possible that we may still be in something like this here. So in fact, on a linear scale, the wedge looks a little bit more pronounced, although I'm not entirely happy about dropping it down to that, you know, but maybe say, if we ignore this here and just draw this like that, then it's possible that we could, once this retracement is over to the upside, we'll get another zigzag down there like that, you know, to maybe in the area of what we're seeing, 120, maybe even lower, or even if it gets to about 80, 85. That is my preferred outcome, ideally. And then we can go into a new cycle, which will go back and retest that low. If, however, that doesn't happen, then what we might have, and we have to be prepared for, is this. Is that whatever has happened up till now is actually part of this piece. See this here zigzag that we saw? So it might actually be part of that zigzag. And that zigzag would be defined by saying, let me just change the color of that to something different. We'll say green. So that might be like a zigzag here. And we have gone back up there to here. And then a connection. And then we get another zigzag. So that zigzag would be this, that, and that, and the entire, so we could double zigzag with a connection in between, okay? So the entire part would then be classed like a W. That's a larger W, so I'll put that in a capital and bracket, larger W. X and Y. Okay, so that's one possibility, in which case we have finished the first piece of the zigzag. But it's made up of double zigzag. So we finished this part here. It's possible that we finished this first piece here. Now we are in the second piece. So that second piece could be, and if we get that, then that would definitely discount the count we've been following in this area. All of these counts will be wrong, and more likely we'll be reverting to this count here. We'll be reverting to this count here somewhere, right? So in that zigzag, what we would get is that we have already started with a minor zigzag, like that, right? That could be first zigzag. We'll then get some kind of a zigzag correction. And this is a freehand drawing, so it's not all scale. So don't focus too much on actual pricing level, just the idea and outline. So we'll get first zigzag up, retracement back, and we'll get a second zigzag also going up like that. Something like that. But if you look at the structure, then maybe what might happen on that structure is we've got something like this one here is a fairly significant area. In that area. So it's possible we might get this going on. So overall, we might finish up by this being the first piece of the zigzag. Then we get a retracement zigzag back up, right? And I will change the color of that. So we'll get something like this here. Something like that. And then get a five wave down. So we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, something like that down. Okay. Eventually that low will probably drop to a level where it's taken out the previous low. And this one could drop to like 80 or somewhere in that area. So that is a possibility. But in that possibility, we have to completely review of a count we started off with an assumption. So if we get something like this, then it will resemble this pattern. It will resemble this pattern, even though if the B doesn't get as high as that, but it's possible for B to get there as well. But the slight variance of this is this one, where you get, but I don't think that's likely, but it's possible, where you get this B going so high, it actually goes beyond where the A started. And in a normal sense, most people will say that this is going to be a new bullish move, and it would be, because if you can imagine that on a Bitcoin, what it would mean is that from 151, we put a low in, and if it goes beyond the origin of wave A, that means going beyond the November 2013 high. But in terms of Elliott wave, it will still remain in a bearish cycle, because once that's complete, we will then come down in a five wave cycle and take out the low we made at 151, right? I think that is less likely, but that is an extreme possibility. And at this moment, there is no one with any kind of approach and analysis will be able to say for certainty that is likely. So we are saying based on Elliott wave, that is a possibility, and I would still not change my terminology. I would appreciate that this would be a big bullish move, and anybody would call me a fool for saying that this is the bearish cycle, but overall it would still be part of the bearish cycle correction. Even if we get that, I think this is less likely. So more likely is this. So if I was to put percentages on, I would say this is probably about 10 to 15%, maybe 20% maximum. This one here probably be 20 to 50% is possible. And what that would mean on Bitcoin is that from this low, we go back and retest the November 2013 high, and then drop in a five wave. So even that would probably be less than 50%, I think. So a higher probability, probably 60, 70 to 80%, I think, more likely is we'll get something like this one, or combination of that. And in this combination, on the Bitcoin, what it would mean is the chart I was just showing you now, this one here, is we get this WXY as the first part of the zigzag. We now go up and do a second part of the zigzag. So this WXY completes the first part. So on the textbook pattern, we would call this one a capital wave A. And we go back here to make a capital wave B. Then we come down in this capital wave C. So that would be same as this pattern, except that this B doesn't go as high. It will remain somewhere around here and give us what is more normal, i.e. this pattern here, right? No, more normal. So the only difference being that in the first one, instead of having a five wave, we've got a zigzag to W. Right, that's wave A. Then we get wave B, and we get five wave down. So that I think is highly probable, and in which case we could get this one. If this is not a significant low, but is a relatively important low, then it's possible for this one to go up. And it's possible in terms of general structure, right? The other structure you see is probably around a little bit lower down. If you take this one out and you put it, say, around here, if you put it around there, then that would be like this spike, first spike. Then we had this candle closing, you know, on there. Here we had a pivot. So it doesn't matter whether I put this line here or a little bit higher, or a little bit lower. That's not what I'm trying to illustrate. What I'm illustrating is that a possibility boundary is, you know, somewhere in this area, because there we have, you see this high, so maybe become a resistance again. So on the upside, we are looking for is around about 6680, maybe 700, and maybe even an absolute, maybe 800 somewhere over here, right? As a general broad brush kind of outline. So that is one. And then on the lower side, it could be somewhere around here, maybe even here, because there we had, you know, the spike slowed, spike below, but recovered. Here we had a little bit of support, but nothing much to play at really. But see this on a weekly, this candle here going up, close there, and the next candle open there. So maybe say use that. And then in that area approximately where we had this spike into it. So somewhere in that region, which is approximately 460 to 500 area. So we could get a zigzag up. All of this I'm looking at, we could do some messy correction. There could be, it might not be as clean as I'm suggesting on here. It could be really, really messy. Believe me, when you see a messy, you haven't seen anything messy yet when you see on a weekly chart. If you start seeing this kind of a chart on this, and you see all this kind of a thing, that nonsense in a 4 hour, you might actually see that on a bigger daily chart forming in that area, you know, which would give you the cycle B. So cycle B could go there, or it could even end up here, somewhere in here with a lot of messy sideway action, up and down, you know, a couple of days, and it goes in about $100 up, and then dies down, and a couple of days dropped down by $60, $70, $80, you know, that kind of messy, or even more messier. But, you know, I think it will be very hard for a very clear perspective to see exactly where the price is going. And maybe the traders will have to be on their toes and will have to be willing to be very disciplined and very controlled, using low leverages and really clear money management. Otherwise, it would literally exhaust and I think... blow several accounts, many accounts, simply because you just can't get a handle on it. 1 minute you think it's going to go up, and the next thing everything that you analyze falls apart and it goes the other way. So we could get something like that, or we'll be more fortunate in getting a clear, just like relatively clear on a weekly chart, we see relatively clear pattern, we might see something like that to form a wave B. So if we don't drop down immediately and take out this low, just remember that I am not insisting on that happening right now. If it happened, that would be my best outcome. And my triangular that I've been following will probably be over, and I'll be more than happy for that pattern to complete, because then we are clear in an uptrend as soon as that is over. But if it doesn't, then the alternative I'm putting out, so even though this chart that I put out here, which I've published, and I've said it's provisional. Where is it? This one, I've said it's provisional. But if we see a subsequent, this downtrend channel taken out, or price doing something different, you know, maybe going up to 600, like we said, or 500, then I need you to remember that I am explaining to you why that would happen. And if that happened, you should not conclude that is most important. You should not conclude that you are in a new bullish cycle, because that will be simply this messy price action I'm suggesting If I get back to the right one, where is it? Lost my page here. So I'm expecting that to happen, and this is the reason why it would happen, and we would then come down. I wouldn't expect you or encourage any of you to become so bullish that you think now this is going to go, literally going to go to the moon. Be absolutely prepared. Even if that happens and we find that we take out this 320 and 300 and we go to 360 and we even take out 360 and go to 400 and even higher, then it's happening because it is preparing people to get so bullish, get involved, and they'll be slaughtered during this line. Absolutely slaughtered, right? So that's the reason why it would happen. The others that we said could happen, but I'm saying it's less likely, is this be, instead of finishing here, this be going all the way to retest this and then dropping down like that. That I think is probably 10% or less, okay? The other one would be this one going up to simply within the close proximity, even if it doesn't go higher, close proximity of that, like over here, like say 980 somewhere, and then dropping down. That is also possible. So this section that I'm talking about, B, can go up to there without disqualifying any of the things that we've already discussed. That is possible, but I think it is less likely, probably holding less than 30%, probably 20 or less than 20% even. But more likely is this one. This is more likely, I think, is that if we did break up and we went up, then be prepared, it will be zigzag up, double zigzag up to possibly around about 600 on upper end, more likely to be lower somewhere, and then dropping in a five-way pattern to the downside, or do some silly messy within a fairly tight close range, but simply go sideways until something happens, some kind of a news, some kind of a fundamental event, some exchange is going bust, or some legislation been applied, or some major crooks have been caught, and therefore the legal system feels that they have to come in and apply legislation to make things safer. Anything like that could happen, and then that would set off this leg down. So I have no idea what will actually cause prices to do what it needs to do, but overall, this low is not the final low for this bearish cycle. That would be my final conclusion, and I'm laying out two possible outcomes, is that we complete this and take out that low and then head up. That's preferred. And the second alternative is to do some messy bit here to form a connection between wave A and wave B. And when that connection is finished, we will have five wave leg to the downside. So from all these corrections that you see, they are really variation of themes. But when you look at them all, they're all this pattern. Whether this B goes higher or it doesn't go as much higher and stops like this one, but it's just that. This pattern, if you squeeze it tight, so you press the B down, you get this one, right? And if you don't, if you leave it where it is, then B goes up to the origin of A. But we're not favoring that. I don't think that that's a high probability. So we'll get some kind of a combination of this, what we are saying, with a wave A, zigzag, and then some kind of connection to form a wave B. And then we see wave C coming down in a five-way pattern. Those are the common pattern we would say in the state where the market is. And unless this one holds, then we will be prepared for this other one. And that would still allow us to expect a new high, but modified in a sense that they will be following this count that we have outlined here. And in this count, we will be looking at wave five, this in magenta, square bracket wave five. It could go up to retest November high or make a new higher high. But because of this damage, it's taken so long, because of that damage, the upside would also be limited. It wouldn't go too high above the November 2013 high, because, you know, this is really crushed the market, I think. A lot of people are humbled, a lot of people will have lost a lot of money, and it will create such a disbelief that even when this leg go, until part of the time, many people will not even believe that this is a new leg because they'll be burnt so badly and hence they might not participate almost until we get close to the all-time high, and then maybe they'll get the idea that possibly this is high, and very latecomers will come in and they will probably be the one who will be left to hold the hot potato when the market then just declined relentlessly for many, many, many years to come. So that is my general outcome. Question, yes, will we see another frustrating sideway after final low? Yeah, it's very possible. It's very possible that even in this situation that we looked at here, for example, in this situation, it is possible that even if you get this, and say, for example, we have this final low down, this final low down that we are looking at, in the vicinity of 100, 120 or anything like that, it's possible that all of that could actually still just complete this first part. That is very possible. In other words, it would simply be correcting zigzag. So in this zigzag, the only clarity we would have had is we would have had, instead of this being W, we might then be able to label this one as, say, wave A, okay? And then this being wave B. That's the only clarity we would have. And then this, instead of being Y, we will be able to label it as wave C. And in a wave C, we need 5 wave. And therefore, we have a 5 wave. We'd have wave 1 down, wave 2 up, wave 3 down, wave 4 up, and wave 5 down. So, sorry, this wave A would go there, and wave B would go that. So we would have wave A, B, and C, but all in all is done is completed a cycle wave A. So that is a possible variation. So cycle wave A, and then we would still expect some kind of connective wave B before we see a clear five-wave cycle right from the beginning to the end, not like what we've seen here. It will be completely different. And in some way, it might be as clear as impulsive as that. I'm not saying of the same magnitude, but you know, very clear impulsive. It would not be hard to mistake it for something different. It would be fairly clear five wave down. It would be very impulsive, very relentless, very damaging five wave down. So even if we see this falling, it would not be correct to conclude that we have seen the final low and we are going to go straight up in a five wave. So yes, I agree, that is a possibility, but at least it would be a significant low, meaning it would allow the price to at least retrace some substantial part of the entire decline. So in terms of the general horizontal structure, maybe going, you know, back up to the 600, or maybe going up even higher, you know, to something like that, you know, around 800-900. So it would open the door for that. What will help us to clarify if this final low we see here will be the final low and we go into new bullish cycle? The only thing will help us is, instead of seeing price action like this one, like this one, we want a clear five-wave move to the upside on the first cycle up. We don't want a zigzag up like this. We want a clear five-wave. So what we need to see on the chart, on a chart that we were drawing up on here, is that we need a clear five wave up. So from the beginning, we expect five wave up like that. You know, it doesn't have to be exactly in the dimension that I'm drawing, but I'm just drawing it so that, say, for example, you get something like wave 1 up, wave 2 down, wave 3 up, wave 4 down, wave 5 up, like that. And within that first leg, we need a clear five wave. So within that minor first leg, we don't want choppy action. We want clear minor five wave to make up that initial leg. And even within this very minor one, we should see clear five on a smaller time frame. So if this is daily, you drop down to 4 hour, you should be able to see in that first leg, clear five leg. And if you drop down to something like 1 hour or 15 minutes, and even in the very first one, you should see a clear five wave. There should be very clear, dynamic, unmistakable, unoverlapping price action. So until we see that, it's unlikely that we will be in a new bullish cycle. So, but we will review that once we start getting that price action unfolding, until then, we are still in this possible falling wedge to see a new final low. And hopefully that's the end. But if it's not the end, then we may get this, what I've got in a square, a zigzag to the upside with a new final low to come. So this cycle, and many people who are expecting that this is the low and we'll never see this low again, they will have to review their views when the price action tells them otherwise. So that, I think I've done enough in terms of laying out what I think 2015 will hold and the alternative. So in summary, is that if this price action holds and we are still in the cycle that we have been following, like this one, but with a modified channel, then we might be willing to accept that being the final low. But to confirm, we need a clear five-way move to the upside to say that that's the final low. And we want the price action confirming right almost from the beginning, clear five-way, not zigzags, okay? So that's the first and preferred outcome. The second one would be is for this to finish, and then we do this ABC correction to the upside or zigzag to the upside for a wave B connection, and then we see five-way move to the downside. And in doing that, the general upper end of the B could be 4,500, could go up to 6 or even 700 to this high here, or even a little bit higher, could go up to 800 or even more, maybe almost right up till here, as we said. But then we'll see another drop down. And in doing that, we must not assume that we are in a new bullish cycle and therefore go all in and, you know, like an investment, long-term investment. Unless, of course, you catch it at the bottom and you're watching, you know, carefully so that if there's any serious weakness, you're willing to come out. Unless you're willing to do that, then it's not an investment cycle. It could be a trading cycle. And even in that, we will not necessarily get a clear up-down zigzag. See, over here, it's not been absolutely clear. So we might get that kind of a choppy, overlapping, you know, faking out moves, all of that thrown together to form this wave B connection before it falls. Whether it goes up to here or it goes up to 900 or only remain below 4, that's immaterial. Any of those things are possible, but you know, it will not be a new bullish cycle. That would be the major thing to take out. And then the third one and the final one is that if we actually have a major wave 5 cycle finished here, then we will do lots of combinations of this, because in this corrective pattern, although we are looking for overall correction, you can see that once you start combining and putting things together, you know, we could get really, really complex pattern where you get, you know, zigzag down, zigzag up, and then we get another zigzag down, and all of that might actually coming down here, and all of that might just form what we would have seen for this one to form. You know, then do another big choppy move sideways before completely correcting. And in which case we would spend several years. But I think, you know, a little bit too early to go into that possibility, but it's an outcome that I would not be completely surprised by. But what is feasible and what we see now, then the two possibilities are that we see a final low here in this web going to five-way up, or that will be just the first part of the correction. And we then see this middle correction, middle connecting wave, before seeing a five wave down to complete the entire bearish cycle. So that's the end for me. If there's any question, then you're welcome to type them in. Have a look. Yeah, somebody commented earlier on that the zigzag I was pointing to earlier was coinciding with the time frame of Silk Road auction. You know, I do remember that, yes. And development like that, you know, whatever positive, negative development sometimes will actually cause market peaks and troughs. Sometimes the price is already in motion and then a news would come and it's not taken into account and it would actually propel the market in the direction it's already in. whether it's to the downside or upside. So fundamentals do have a effect on the market. I don't dismiss it, but personally, simply because of my limitations, both in terms of availability and my personal ability to actually comprehend all of this and then bring it out into some kind of a concise formula, I can't do it. So I don't agonize too much on it, but I keep it in mind. If something lines up with the price and I can identify it, then it could become an added indication to your analysis. So that's how I look at fundamental, whether it's Bitcoin or fundamentals in terms of other, like, you know, major markets. And one final chart that I was going to show you is a chart of S&P 500. I've already said that we have a very close, relatively close, high correlation, positive correlation. Even if you don't give it like a 90%, but, you know, I think it's good 70, 75%, 80% correlation between S&P 500 and Bitcoin. So if the Bitcoin has gone into this bear cycle, when this one is still going up, in a common sense, you would look at, if there was an indicator like that, you would say that's a major divergence. Now, major divergence doesn't mean market must change course straight away just because you see a divergence. Sometimes divergence will continue for much longer. Sometimes you'll see single degree divergence, double degree divergence. And what I mean is, here on S&P 500, on RSI, you see there was a major top here in 96, but the price continued to go up and it created this single degree divergence. So we had a correction, market went up again, came back almost within the vicinity of all-time high, but the RSI didn't, it made a lower high. And now S&P 500 is going into a new all-time high, but RSI is producing a new lower high. So what you've got is a lower highs on the RSI, higher high on the price, but the divergence is now more than double degrees. This was single degree. This here became double degree. Now you've got third degree divergence in the play. And if you start looking at, you know, on a different time scale, you might see that even in this final end, we've got a potential divergence on RSI, but the price is still pressing ahead. So you've got, you know, several layers of divergences, but the price hasn't actually completely reversed. Although it did have some correction. So if S&P 500 is moving up like that and been going up, you know, with the rest of the market for, you know, say, you know, much longer, but even from 1987, when the market crashed very sharply in October 1987, and it's been going up ever since. And this was a short-term congestion of some sort and now made a new term high. That means that the bullish cycle that started from 87 and even earlier is still fully intact. So we've had correction in between, but these correction in between were correcting market movement of intermediate cycle. But the larger cycle that started from 87 is still intact, but it could be now coming to a conclusion. So the correction we would see would be severe and of a larger magnitude than the ones we had in this area, because this correction was probably correcting whatever started off here. This is 87, started of 87 here. So this cycle started even earlier, probably from, you know, 1981, 82, after the major recession that was several years recession, and market went sideways for almost like 10 years or more. So this cycle started off from there. So whatever this was correcting was only probably correcting move from 87. Then we had the second correction here, and maybe all of that correction was combined because it's like in a WXY we were looking at. So maybe this was A, B, and C, or it was W, X, and Y, whichever, but it's finished a zigzag, is now gone up to all-time high. So when that finishes, it would be correcting a much larger cycle that started even from earlier than 87 and even earlier from 80, 82. So one would reason that the magnitude of the correction would be bigger than what we had here. So that's all I'm trying to show with this particular chart. But so if the correction happened, then we come back to this November 2009 low, that would be a significant correction because we are starting from a higher level. And previously, we had from 2000 to 2002, October, it was nearly 36 months, 37 months. Then this correction only lasted 17 months. So you could expect this correction, being of a larger degree, could last for more than 17 months, probably 34 months, maybe even 4 years, 48 months, maybe longer. But certainly more than a year and a half to 2 years. That's the general conclusion we would come to. So if we had that kind of decline in a major equity market, and we have high correlation in the S&P 500 and BTC, so if the S&P corrected for a couple of years, you can see what BTC will do. BTC cannot, in that couple of years, go on to make a new time high. It's possible, not impossible, absolutely. But it is less likely and highly improbable for a BTC to go up and do that when this major market is not doing, it's in a major bear phase and is correcting a much larger cycle. And the reason why that would happen is because they're both risk instruments. People who want to take a higher risk, like a old couple, for example, will be happy in a gentle family car. The younger, racy, hot-blooded youngster might not be happy with that car. It'd be too boring for him. He'd probably be happier with something like a Spitfire or some fast racing car or something. So Bitcoin is that racing car, whereas the S&P 500 is probably more gentle family car. So other than that, they're both risk instruments. They carry same kind of a risk at a different degree. So people who want to accept higher risk for higher reward in a bullish cycle, they'll go to things like Bitcoin, think S&P 500. They might go to Nasdaq, for example, which is like a younger sister carrying higher risk. So they'll go to Nasdaq, and Nasdaq will start outperforming compared with S&P 500. And likewise, S&P 500 will outperform in a bullish cycle compared with Dow Jones 30, because the larger market don't have the same volatility and is much more gentler compared with the other one. So in that comparison, I can't consider or entertain BTC going up as high, retest 2013 high, if the major market continues to decline. And the other point to remember is this time bar that put on there. They're simply just a measurement bar, nothing more. From the beginning of the low in 87 to this intermediate high was 76 bar. So, okay, one might say, well, why did you measure that? Why didn't you measure from there to somewhere else? But just for the time being, accept that that's a 76 bar. From that same low, I made a measurement to all-time high to millennium high, 2000. And it happened to be 72 bars. So I think to myself, that's interesting. This one was 76, that was 72. Can't get too carried away just because you got two measurements similar. So then I measured the low in October 2002 to the low of 2003, and it happened to be 76 bar. And now I'm beginning to get a little bit, excited, because this 76 and that 76 is coincidental, or is very high coincidental. So what happens now? I'm thinking to myself, what happens now if I put 76 bar measured from this low? Well, that's bringing me up to approximately June, July of this year. So that's one thing. Then I measured the November, the 2000 high to this 2007 high, and it happened to be 91 bars. So I said to myself, okay, well, we had a reasonable repeat of bars here. So supposing we have this 91 bars also repeat at the top 91 bars, so high to high 91 bars. So if you measure 91 bars from high of 2007 to possibly high of this year, that brings me to May. So now using this time frame, I'm looking at possibly somewhere between May to July is a possible turning window. But then that turning window also happens to be at the time when the price level is such where, remember Fibonacci relationship we talked about earlier? So if you do measurement of this leg and you let it retrace, so if you have 100% retracement, you'll come back to 2007 high and then continue retracing upward, 161.8% comes in approximately where the price is now. But the way the Elliott wave do is they measure this leg, that's a low from there to a high, applied from this low, then 161% extension of that comes in at approximately 2,220 on S&P 500. So S&P 500 go a little bit more room to the upside. But basically, what is interesting is that now we have a possible time window and we have a possible price window. But then look at the indicators. On the RSI, you see these three layers of divergences I highlighted, and potential this trend line has already been breached. This minor trend line going from this low, connecting this intermediate higher lows, has been breached already. Doesn't mean the market is turning, but it is now on a warning signal. And then look at the MACD, standard MACD. Standard MACD previously signaled a serious decline, and we are in a process of that being crossed down. So I'm thinking to myself, we're in a time-wise, we're in a window. Price-wise, we are there. Indicators suggesting that. So conclusion I'm laying back to is if S&P 500 actually does what I'm saying, something like big drop, what do you think this is going to do? Just keep that in mind. Don't dismiss it. If everybody is running away from the risk, and this S&P 500 is less riskier than Bitcoin, if people are running away from this risk, what do you think they're going to do with the Bitcoin? Could this mean that the Bitcoin will actually not have any significant upside? And even if it doesn't collapse all the way to like 1 and 5, could it be that Bitcoin could go into this kind of messy terminal side eventually to complete the connecting wave? So we got WXY is a wave A, some kind of connecting wave, flat B, and then dropping like that, or could it be that we might actually continue a little bit higher now while the S&P 500 is still forming a top, go back and kiss the current trend line we have, and then along with the major market drop? And if that happened, then more likely we already have the major top we were looking at. This top, we already have it. And so we are now in a major several years of correction on Bitcoin. So that is all. I hope I didn't bore you too much. But if there's any other questions or you want me to clarify something, then I can go over that. We have covered the agenda we had, which is review our initial assumptions. And we are beginning to question that and have a couple of possible alternatives. We have compared the current price decline and why we don't think that November price since November 2013 high has actually put in a final low. So the January 2015 low is not the final low. And we've laid out a couple of outlines of possible outcome leading beyond 2015, both for the bullish cycle and probably more trying and testing sideways movement cycle with a lower targets to follow. So in terms of the current chart, this chart will still continue. This chart will still continue as a guideline until we've seen what happens when the price goes out of that channel, and therefore it's provisional. And if the price goes up there, then we'll review it. And more likely, we will relabel some of these labels for both this bearish cycle as well as possibly the larger cycle, according to the way that I just explained in this session. So any questions? Have I got some of you with me? Have I lost you all? And this spread chart for the Litecoin and Bitcoin. Again, follows the rule of in a bullish cycle, the higher risk instrument outperforms the lower risk instrument. So between the LTC and BTC, we have BTC possibly as a less risky. To me, they're both very risky, but between the two of them, less risky. LTC is probably higher risk. So you can see during this bearish cycle, LTC has continued to decline, showing weakness. But whether these wave counts are absolutely correct or not, I don't know, depending on what happens and how the BTC develops. But for the time being, we're following that. So we still got a potential another low to follow on the spread chart, pardon me, on the spread chart, suggesting that we may still have another low in Bitcoin. That's all from me. So what do you say? Any questions, comments? The session will be recorded, I'm assuming, hoping it will be recorded. And you'll be able to review that in time. Use it for your own analysis. I'd be happy to have feedback from you, any comments, you know, constructive comments, you know, things that might help you and might help me, but anything else, you know, is best perhaps you keep it to yourself, because, you know, we're all good at entertaining ourselves and we all consider too wise in our own eyes. So if there's anything along that line, then best not to show yourself up. But if you think that there's something that's going to help, then I would be happy to consider, both from your knowledge of Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies, and possibly from technical analysis approach. Always open to that. Never too proud of that. But, you know, certainly wouldn't give too much attention if somebody just wants to have a pot shot at somebody for the sake of doing that. It doesn't really speak much for them, neither does it do any good for the recipients. So anyway, that's all from me. Any comments, any question? Otherwise I'll call this to an end. Type into that TV chat room. Okay, what's the most important level in a short term? In the short term, I would say, whichever chart you follow in terms of, let me just take all the drawing tools off here. Okay, so whether you follow it on a log scale or linear scale, doesn't matter. But if you, for example, do nothing more than just simply put levels on like this, like, you know, many people are familiar of doing, right? Something like that. Maybe this one to ignore the spike and maybe the candle low, because they had a spike into that area. So in terms of horizontal level, maybe one more level there, right? So in a very short term, in terms of horizontal, those are the possible levels you could be looking at, both on the upside and downside. Is that on the upside, you have about 300, 320, which I've been saying for several weeks based on that roadmap we are following. Get to it in the end. On this roadmap here. So based on that, you know, that is the first level. Next on the upside will be 400, maybe 420 zone. If you are looking at a trend line and potential triangle or the falling wedge that I was describing, then in terms of that, you can probably narrow it down a little bit more, because in that case, it needs to hold this wedge and you're getting narrower and narrower. So on the downside, you really want the last spike of 150 holding. And if it drops below that, then, you know, about 100 to 180, 100 to 80. So that, somewhere there, okay? On the downside, if the triangle doesn't hold, then the upside is 320 or higher, and the next one will be 400 and above. And if you change that to log scale, and then these triangles change somehow. So this trend line changes somewhat and to become something like this. So on the upside, horizontal levels still remain the same. They don't change necessarily. But the upside, again, as long as that trend line holds, then 300 to 320 will probably hold. If it does that fairly quickly, if it takes a long time, then of course the 320 to hit that, the trend line will be breached. And many people will start concluding that that trend line breach now mean that the bearish trend is over. So that's what people will conclude. And then the upside is still remain 300, 320, maybe 400. And above that will be 650 in the short term. But the very short term, 320, I think, is a key level for several reasons, both because the dropping trend line restricts it, horizontal lines also restrict it, and based on our linear chart, we were expecting an overall falling wedge sort of limits the upside. So 300 to 320 is a very short-term upside. Downside is 151 to be retested or new low formed. Any other questions? Okay, well, I appreciate you all spending time with me. Hope that my discussion has been useful, not just necessarily to the Bitcoin, but also applying similar kind of techniques of looking at a spread chart like LTC and BTC, looking at comparative charts of S&P 500 and Bitcoin or some other instruments. If you're looking at maybe say S&P 500 and check that with Nikkei index or something like that to do a correlation study, and then use a common trading technical analysis approach, trend line, channel, Fibonacci's, whole host of them, whatever you feel you're comfortable with. Even on the indicators, I commonly use MACD, RSI, and stochastic, but there are times when I will check other indicators, maybe something like on balance volume or ADX, and all of these simply not just to add or clutter up the chart, but only if they're giving me a better picture. It's like looking at a scene, and you look at it from a certain angle, and you can see more detail from certain angle than other angle. So, indicators, I only use them if I think they're actually helping or clarifying. If they're not, then I just don't use them and take them off. In the earlier Bitcoin liquidity market, I agree. It was hardly traded. I agree. The data beyond this one is actually available from a exchange when it wasn't traded. Even the very even this part, you can't, because you see this spike. I don't know what to make of that spike. I don't know whether to put a label on it because it looks like 1 week. But if you look at it on a daily, it might actually turn out it's probably just 1 day, or even 1 hour price. And Bitcoin has a tendency to do that. So I don't know whether I should have put a label on there or not put a label on there. So I agree. The earlier price history is probably less reliable. And so it's even more suspect when somebody has used, it seems like somebody's used a gold price somehow put some kind of formula or some kind of derivative thing to arrive at these other levels. I have no idea. And therefore, I've been saying that you can't take this for granted. So you start on an assumption. And that's why on my chart, you make an assumption. If the assumption hold, then you expect certain things. But if the assumption do not hold, then your assumption will be challenged or tested. And you will have to revise based on what the price history tells you, as it develops. Shorting, that's another thing. And you see another factor which has also come into play and which was not possible before, just like shorting was not possible before, is a futures market that has been launched in the last few months. And leverage future market. You see, my cynical mind is telling me, just like, for example, recently, the oil has been dropping like a lead balloon, they say, or lead in the water. It's been dropping like that. and you know, it was dropping before the last major meeting of OPEC producers. And just because OPEC producers indicated that they will not cut the production level, the price has continued to drop even further, and maybe more sharply. But you know, people operating in this industry are very knowledgeable about their industry. And the reason I'm explaining that is because, you know, I'm going to put into picture what the futures market in the Bitcoin is doing. So some of these producers are doing that, and they know when the price was falling. I have a chart to tell you that, you know, I felt the major decline was about to take place. I did not expect at that time, to be honest, that the oil will fall as far as it has fallen. Being cautious, I was expecting much gentler and perhaps less of a fall than we have actually seen. But it was not impossible to identify where the, let me show you. I have a chart here for oil. If I can get to it. Oil, is the one that I did a long time ago using, and some of these I've not updated, so you'll probably see analysis on there. You think, wow, you know, this is the old chart. Oil, see this one. This one, you can see it's like 25th of October. That's when I looked at it. But let me just show you on there where I think the oil actually started. I might have even marked it on there. As I said, since October 2014, I've not even looked at it. I was expecting a fall. This is where my last arrow is. I was expecting a fall around about that time. This is the ExxonMobil, by the way. So ExxonMobil, by the way, I was expecting a top in about 95, but it actually went on to 105. No big deal in the overall, but I was expecting a decline. Going back to that other one, if I can pick up the oil chart now. Heating oil. See, this one is March oil and gas. Let's see. Right, you can see this chart. I've not done anything at all. As you can see, that it was not even saved from March 2014. So this is the last when I attended to this chart. I've got this trend line in here, so you can see when you know a serious breach happened. But even closer on the other chart, you'll see which I've done more recently see this one here is February. That's probably fairly recent. Let me show you that one. That's a dollar index with oil, and it was in a classic rising wedge pattern, which is the point I'm trying to make. Oh, that's a ratio chart. That's no good. Oil. Yeah, see, look. So in here, this is a 102. No, I think I'm confusing. This one is a heating oil, the NUMEX ratio chart. I do a lot of ratio analysis because sometimes, you know, what you see in the basic price is enhanced when you see a ratio chart. So I should really clarify that on the ratio chart. I'll come back to it later. But where's the oil? Okay, so this one is done in December 31st. December 31st, and I've not changed anything in that chart since. There, look. See, in here, you see we had a rising wedge, but it's a little bit crude because you got like W, X, Y, then I've got like A, B, and C. But in a way, it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, but this 5 being so weak, it didn't even get to the upper end of that rising wedge. So basically, even if you didn't know the analysis in terms of the Elliott wave, basically a breach of this minor trend line would have been your signal. So the point I'm making is that if I could do that, and in terms of analysis, in terms of time frame, see, I measured this one here from the high, all-time high of oil to this high is 149 bars. So then if you do a Fibonacci ratios of, I think it's 123%, you'll come to 165. And that comes into a proximate zone where I marked where I think the tiny turn could happen. And then that lines up with several other time factors. See, 100 bars, 120 bars, 105 bars, 105 bars. So this 105 by 100, 105 bars seems to be very key, because there was 105 bars between this high and that low. So then if you repeat that from that low to the next high, or from this low to the next high, is 105 bars. So both in time and price ratio, you knew that that was potential time window and approximate price somewhere in that area. So if you knew that, and then you can see from my chart, which I've not changed, I was expecting the drop back to the to this level here, somewhere in that area, right? When the price started back in December, I was still expecting price to somewhere around about this level. But we've gone in now to much lower than that. So the point I'm making is that if I could do this, do you think that the people operating in oil industry don't understand where the oil price is going, where the dynamic is, who are the competitors, who are the major oil producers, what are the economic demand? Do you think they don't know that? I think they do. And I think they have, you know, risk department, maybe a technical department, whatever they call it. I think they and they can also buy in specialist research. So they would be able to produce that. So if they knew that this stable price is now actually falling and it's going to drop much lower, what do you think many, not all of them, because even the brightest of mind make terrible mistakes. So I'm not saying all oil producers have done this, but what is to stop some of the oil producers who knew that if the price drops much lower, their financial well-being is going to be called into question or jeopardized? What is to stop them from forward selling their oil? If they forward sell their oil, that means they know that over the next year or so, they can produce X amount of oil based on their current resource and reserve and their daily production level. They can work out how much oil they can produce next year or next 2 years. So what is to stop oil producers selling forward their production, which is still in the well, still in the ground? They haven't brought it out, but they can bring it out. What is to stop them forward selling 6 months, 12 months, 2 years ahead at that current level price, knowing that if it goes up, they won't benefit from it because they already sold at that price. But if it drops down, that they will be financially protected. And I think this steep decline has happened as a result of combination of factors. One, I think the oil producers, OPEC, came in around here somewhere. I forget the exact date, but somewhere around, certainly November, December time, I forget the date now, do excuse me, but somewhere around there, they came up and said they won't stop, but the steep decline was already in progress. So some of the shrewd ones will have already sold a lot of oil at that price. And then the OPEC refused to cut the supply, so then it continued and exasperated the situation to a level where it is now, right? So now whoever sold forward oil a year or 2 years of supply there, they are fairly well secured. They won't suffer. Others will probably be gone into bankruptcy because, you know, they'll have to cut the production simply because their cost of running the production line is costing more than what they're able to sell at. And at the moment, if they sell at current price, they'll be fooled, because if it bounces back, they'll lose out. And equally, if the price continues falling, they'll continue to suffer. So their situation is very difficult now. But a lot of the other people will have already secured their sale at the price, the higher level. So the point I'm making is that when the BTC started falling in the way it has, many people couldn't short it before. Now they can, the traders can, but that can go both ways. But in particular, there may be many BTC miners or who are in the initial chain in the part of BTC coming into being. Then these producers, if you call them producers, many shrewd ones, if they're so good at mining and understanding the technology and knowing which button to press to switch the PC on, like I would have to look at the PC and deliberately look at which button I should press to switch it on. But those people can probably do it sleeping in their bed, knowing which button to press. You know, if they're that clever, what is to stop them from saying when the futures came into contract is that they've actually sold their future supply. They know exactly how much they're likely to produce and are capable of, with the risk that if it goes up, they might not benefit from a price going up. But if the price drops, they will be protected. How many will have sold? And that's why I think maybe that the Bitcoin could have actually found a bottom at the level of 240 that I was expecting earlier on, and based on our roadmap we were expecting. But you know, it's exasperated, and that futures selling might have actually made this particular decline worse. I mean, that's a speculation from my part, but I'm just wondering what was stopping people who knew that they can actually produce this over the next year, they can produce X amount of Bitcoin. What is to stop them forward supply of, you know, selling their sale or production ahead at the level when the price was a higher level? And I don't know exactly when the futures came in, but having a hazardous of guess, and when, you know, based on the chats that I heard, maybe somebody can chime in and put in a comment as to when the futures trading became available. But I suspect maybe somewhere around about, you know, back end of last year, maybe August, September, August, somewhere, you know. So that might have actually twisted or had a bearing on what's happened in the actual price. And the price has become more volatile, and it's become more volatile simply because more leverage available for people to trade, and particularly high leverage on the futures contract, and the fact that a lot of people are trading this both long and short, meaning the leverage and the spikiness. It was spiky before already, but now it's become even more spikier. And that's why you see sometimes nothing happening for hours on end, for days, and then suddenly, boom, 1 hour, and it's done the move. So, you know, that's I expect more of that actually to come in the Bitcoin, until Bitcoin overall value comes to the point where it becomes a lot more stable and very hard to manipulate it to that level. Until then, this spikiness and volatility will actually increase for Bitcoin, I think, if it wasn't enough before. August time, yeah, okay. I mean, thank you for that. So that's what I expect, is that many people, when they realize, because remember over here, there were still a lot of people in the Bitcoin community chat room, they were calling me idiot and all sorts of other names, saying that law in April was not the final law. And many of them even tried to make it appear very, very technical and very scientific. And even one particular chap said, you know, Elliott Wave is untested, there's no results to it. And he apparently came up and started criticizing me in public by saying he's got statistical analysis. Now, statistical analysis he's talking about is because of his age and because of his awareness of financial instrument. I suspect, I could be wrong, I suspect it will be based on what he saw in Bitcoin chart, you know, back from whenever, 2010, 2011. So, you know, a couple of years. So in that couple of years, he apparently thinks he gathered enough statistical module that based on that model, he was suggesting that Bitcoin low we saw in, get back to the right chart, that Bitcoin low we saw here in April was the final low, and that according to him, to counter my particular claim about Bitcoin dropping even further, and he also used this RSI coming back up and adding all of this together with his statistical model, he was expecting this price to go up something like, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 up. Well, instead of 5,000, we're not even near 500 now. You know, so the point I'm making is that you know, there are people who felt that this price is going to continue higher, and there was nothing to stop them from thinking that this is going to drop much further. They didn't even imagine it. They didn't think it was possible. It was not even, you know, remotely possible for Bitcoin to drop this far like it has fallen. And certainly the level I was calling at 400 and lower. So, you know, many producers will have probably thought the same, I think, because it's you know, this feeling is contagious. But the producers will probably know more than the individual traders on their small accounts. You know, and when it started going to the level and it took out this low, I think many of them will have realized that this Bitcoin is not going to go to the moon now. It's going to have a lot more lower price. And then if it came in August, I think they've probably been selling the supply from August, you know, in varying degree for the futures contract to actually work and for somebody to take the risk. Somebody's got to allow that trading. So either they have to take the entire risk non-hedged, or some of the producers will have hedged against their future production to sell at a higher level to allow this trading facility to become available for retail and small short-term traders. Okay, well, I think I've gone on long enough. If anybody ever looks at this video, they might think I've gone mad. Why should I produce such a video, such a long one? But I hope I've done a justice in laying out, you know, my approach and how I look at the technical analysis and what my future expectation is of Bitcoin. I certainly hope it will help you. Thank you for chiming in with me. And if there's any question, then rather than lengthening this particular session, do let me know, both on my chart that I've published in the Bitcoin on the TV, or by you know, in the chat or a PM or other means, and maybe perhaps next time when we do another session, hopefully not so long, we could address that. But in the meantime, thank you for your time, and I'll, with your permission, bring this to an end, close it today. Thank you. My thanks to you for your kind expression of appreciation there. So, with your permission, as I say, I'll call this a day. Thank you very much.